high desert in the great American Southwest. I bid you all good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you may be in the world's prolific time zones covered. Covering all of them. This is Coast to Coast AM. Best radio program of its kind on the air anywhere. How you doing? It's weekend again, everybody, and I'm Art Bell with the weekend version of Coast. Now, there's some pretty cool stuff going on. I don't know how many of you are free StreamLink subscribers, but if you're not, stay tuned. I'll tell you all about it. Normally, StreamLink costs money, but this weekend, you know, like HBO and Showtime, they give you a free weekend every now and then. We're doing that. So it's free. If you want to go up to StreamLink and start listening right now, you can do it free of charge. It's all on the website. That's one. Two is, and I think this is particularly cool, the StreamLink people have decided to allow you all to burn MPEG-3s of the last 30 days of shows. That's in addition to accessing the regular 90-day streaming archive. And I think that is really excellent. So this weekend, Friday, March 12th through Sunday, March 14th, you can listen on StreamLink free of charge. Whole free weekend, just like HBO and Showtime and all the rest of them do every now and then. We're doing it. And I think that's a grand idea. And I think being able to burn to MPEG-3 is really cool. Really, really cool. That means you can, make a CD or whatever you want to do. So all of that available up on the website at coasttocoastam.com right now. Now, let's see. A couple of off-the-bat things. I've got a really good photograph of our crazy cat Yeti. He's the fourth one we acquired. We have four cats in this household and have had for a long time. Yeti is a special cat. He came bounding in from out of nowhere in the desert. We have a garden, and in our garden we grow catnip with everything else. So if there wasn't enough of a neon sign flashing above this house now saying, all cats, yo-ho, here it is, free ride, whatever, it brings them the catnip growing out there probably. Anyway, he came bounding into the catnip one afternoon, just doing flip-flops, so happy to see us, looking like a show cat. I mean, this is, I've got to admit, this is a beautiful, beautiful cat. And by the way, he knows it. He sits in the mirror and looks at himself and thinks, whoa, tiger. I'm sure you've seen that photograph, right? But he does think a lot of himself, and he is beautiful. And I caught him sitting on the scales, you know, where you weigh yourself in the kitchen, and he just sat there waiting for me to take his photograph. He wanted me to take his photograph, and if you look at this, you'll see he's one beautiful cat. He has a mane like a tiger. He is just beautiful, and he loves me. He follows me like a little dog everywhere. So that's Yeti on the webcam tonight. Very proud of that cat. Antenna update, it's all done, working incredibly beyond, almost in a supernatural way, actually. We're going to get a helicopter and bring a helicopter out here probably later this week and go and take readings around the antenna. This is going to be really cool, really instructive. I'm going to end up putting up a website about this antenna, probably theoldartbell.com, which I have retained. Anyway, it's going to go up about the antenna, not for a while yet, so don't bother trying to hit anything that's not there yet. Goes nowhere right now. Now, weird news of the world. In a videotaped message, a man purporting to represent Al-Qaeda claims the terrorist network was behind the bombings that killed 200, wounded 1,500 in Madrid. They're calling the Spanish 9/11. Now, they sent a tape. There's been an arrest of three Moroccan and two Indian suspects. And this, of course, is the strongest indication yet of an Al-Qaeda link to the whole. You know, we're going to have to kill these people pretty quickly, too. I mean, there's just nothing else. We're going to have to kill them. The world's nations are going to have to kill them. They cannot blow up buildings. They cannot kill people en masse in Spain or anywhere else in the world. They have to be killed. And so I'm sure we're on that as hard as we can be right now. But there's nothing else to it. They want to kill us. We must kill them first. Here's a story. A man suspected of murdering 9 of his family members apparently was involved in polygamy and incest, fathering 2 of the victims with his own daughters, police said Saturday. The bodies of 6 females and 3 males, ages 1 to 24, were found tangled in the back room of Marcus Wesson's home Friday. It is Fresno's largest mass slaying. A head shaker. It's too awful. Just too awful. The hunt for Osama bin Laden is ratcheting up. We've got thousands of troops on the move looking for him. This eastern Afghanistan, lawless kind of area, and that's got to be one hell of a hunt. John Kerry locked up the nomination, so he's going to be the man facing George Bush, and the campaign seems to be in full swing. I'm sure you've noticed. Everybody was waiting for the news on the DARPA challenge. Well, the DARPA challenge was to make a vehicle that could navigate itself across the desert. You know, recognize obstacles, figure out ways to do for itself, and it didn't go very well. We may not be seeing any robot driver's licenses issued anytime soon. All 15 self-navigating vehicles in a 150-mile race across the Mojave Desert were knocked out within just a few miles of the starting gate. Kaboom! So nobody gets the prize, and it's back to the drawing board for those who want the million. In a moment, we'll leave this weird news and get to the really weird news. Stay right there. Those of you that have something you would like to get on the air would be well to be dialing now, since we will do some open lines this hour. And then, oh, by the way, next hour, Benjamin Baruch. Benjamin Baruch. Now, this is an interesting guy. He, maybe I shouldn't go into it. But it has to do with, it's going to have to do with religion, because God spoke to this man. But he's really a market player, you know, stock market player. This is going to be an interesting interview. I really do think it is. That's coming up next hour. Now, Monday, I'm hearing some rumors on the web that Monday there is going to be a NASA briefing given. I guess some Dr. Brown, an associate professor of planetary astronomy at the California Institute of Technology, is going to give some sort of briefing regarding some kind of object that he's found out there. All very mysterious, but that news will be breaking on Monday, and I'm sort of curious. What do you think he's going to? Planet X, maybe? Now, that'd be bigger than this, right? So, some sort of asteroid that might be on a collision course with us? Maybe. Some new planetary body that he's found? Probably. We'll see. All right. The whole thing about the climate continues to swirl. Sorry for that. Scientists gagged by number 10, meaning Downing Street. After warning of global warming threat, Downing Street tried to muzzle the government's top scientific advisor. Muzzle him! After he warned that global warming was a more serious threat than international terrorism. Ivan Rogers, Mr. Blair's principal private secretary, told Sir David King, who would be none other than the Prime Minister's chief scientist, to limit his contact with the media after he made some outspoken comments about President George Bush's policy on climate change. They told him shut up. In England, you can do that. In January, Sir David wrote a scathing article in the American Journal of Science attacking Washington for failing to take climate change seriously. In my view, he says, climate change is the most severe problem we are facing today, more serious than even the threat of terrorism. And here's another one. Let's see, this one, news and city section of what? The Evening Standard Political Report. The government's chief scientist, today set out an apocalyptic vision of global warming, bringing back the conditions which drove the dinosaurs to extinction. Professor Sir David King told a House of Lords committee that urgent action was needed, quote, within the next few years, end quote, to avert the threat of sudden and severe climate change. So they're thinking we can avert sudden and severe climate change. That's interesting. He claimed that last summer's heat wave was man-made event, warned things are going to get worse. He defied Downing Street by repeating his charge that global warming is a bigger threat than terrorism and that Washington is failing to tackle the problem. This is really turning into a serious story, beginning to come at us from just about every direction out there. Pretty interesting, huh? There's a story. You know, I don't know about these, and I don't know about Pravda. Pravda, of course, is the most famous Russian newspaper publication in the world. So the following story is coming to you from Pravda. A little of the English is perhaps not quite right, but it's straight from Pravda. The headline is "Time has been one of the most complicated and less studied scientific issues since ancient times." Now, I can't guarantee that what I'm about to read you really happened, but it's in Pravda. Here it is. 8 years ago, American and British scientists who conducted investigations in Antarctica made a sensational discovery. U.S. physicist Marion McLean told the researchers, were told they noticed some spinning gray fog. Listen to me now, spinning gray fog over the pole on January 27th, which they believed to be just ordinary sandstorm of some sort. However, the gray fog did not change its form, did not move in the course of time. The researchers decided to investigate the phenomena, and they launched a weather balloon with equipment capable of registering, you know, wind speed, temperature, air moisture content, but the weather balloon soared upwards and immediately disappeared. In a little while, the researchers brought the weather balloon back to the ground with the help of a rope attached to it previously. They were extremely surprised to see that the chronometer set in the weather balloon displayed the date January 27th, 1965, the same day only 30 years ago. The experiment was repeated several times after the researchers found out the equipment was in good repair, so they went back and repeated this experiment, it says. The phenomena, they called it a time gate. They claim they reported the whole thing to Washington. Today, investigation of the unusual phenomena is underway. It is supposed that what they're calling the Whirl Crater above the South Pole is a tunnel allowing penetration into other times. This is pretty wild stuff, I know. What is more, programs on launching people to other times have been started. The CIA and FBI are fighting in trying to gain control over the project that may change the course of history. It is not clear when the U.S. federal authorities will approve the experiment. Now, go look for this yourself. If you want to confirm it, you can get to Pravda on the web. And the name of the article is "Time Can Be Turned Back," 3-1-2004. Published 3-1-2004, and I know a lot of you are going to want to go and look for this. It is so intriguing, the whole concept of time, the concept of time travel. The whole thing is a mind-blower for me. I've always been totally fascinated by it. And here is an article claiming there's this gray, whirling mass straight at the South Pole that turns watches back and may even allow travel in time, and straight at the South Pole. Now, I don't know. I don't think it's a joke. It might be. I, you know, but I pulled it from Pravda, so go find the article yourself and see what you think of it. I was sort of blown away, say the least. All right, let's, so that we have time to get to calls, which I definitely want to get to, let's plunge in. First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, is it Aaron?
It is.
Hi, I had a question concerning dimensions.
Dimensions, all right.
Yeah.
Sure.
I've always wondered, I've heard like higher beings or higher dimensions, like fourth dimension, five dimension, and I've always wondered, has there ever been any research into like two dimensions?
Two dimensions. Well, two dimensions is like you see on TV. In other words, in two dimensions, there is no depth.
Right.
Right? The third dimension adds the depth.
Well, I was just wondering...
So has there ever been research into two dimensions? Yes. Not nightly on your television, sir. That's about it. I think there's not too much magical, and you can serve that one up any way you want about the second dimension. Yeah, I could be wrong, but the only research I'm aware of is that applied to... the one-eyed monster and, well, movie theaters and other aspects of life, photographs, that sort of thing. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, Art. This is Ed. I'm in Los Angeles, listening on KFI, 640 AM.
Yes.
Yeah, the big KFI. A couple of things. First, have you ever had anybody talking about dowsing? And has anybody ever flown an ornithopter?
Flown a what?
Ornithopter. That's a flying machine that flies by flapping its wings.
Well, I've seen attempts of that on video, but they always crashed real fast. I've had dreams where I did real well, and I was able to flap my wings and fly. That's about it, though. And with respect to your first question, sir, I know a fair amount about dowsing. My wife is a dowser. I've watched her find water again and again. She can do it. Here's a very brief little story for you. We're going to buy a house in an area where I'm now thankful we didn't, here in the Pahrump Valley. It was up on, way up on a hill. You know, a place a ham radio operator would choose, right? Up on a hill. And it was pretty rocky. And so before, when we were in, you know, sort of thinking about buying property, Ramona took a couple of coat hangers, turned them into a dowsing setup, and went down into the very far, far corner of the property, an unlikely place, I thought, and said, here's water. Well, that property went undeveloped for several years. And it's funny, once it was finally developed, this is pretty interesting, they put a house on it, they drilled one well, and it was dry. They pulled the rig up and moved the rig to a second point where Ramona had indicated they should, and there was the water. So, you know, does dowsing work? I think it does. How does it work? I don't have the slightest idea. First time caller line, you're on the air.
Yeah, this is Mark from Garden City, Michigan.
How you doing, Mark?
Okay, you just blew my mind about that time thing, but...
Me
there's
too.
There's a guy named, this is on another thing, your antenna?
Oh, yes.
There's a guy named James Harris Rogers that had some patents on antennas, mostly underground ones, but he might have had some above ground ones. So if you're wondering about your voltage?
Yes.
Well, that was pretty interesting.
You think there might be something in those patents with regard to the voltage on the antenna?
Yeah, it could be. A lot of Tesla stuff.
Well, I think, you know, and you're hesitant to say this kind of thing, but I think that that's exactly where this leads. All roads, when you're talking about the phenomena I seem to be repeatedly able to demonstrate here, sometimes, shockingly so to myself and others, yeah, all roads lead to Tesla and the kind of work Tesla was doing, and the claims Tesla made weren't so crazy. Maybe there is a transformer effect that allows the gathering of energy from the difference in potential between the atmosphere and the Earth, whatever it is. Or it may be something else entirely. I mean, we're kind of jumping to conclusions here a little bit, aren't we? But again, all roads, when you're talking about this, really do seem to lead toward the incredible Mr. Tesla. So there's going to be a whole lot more experimentation that is about to go on, and we're going to know more about all of this soon, but it is really cool stuff. I mean, there's no question about it. Coming out of apparently nowhere, there's about 300 volts of electricity on that antenna. Not a great deal of current, but enough to be doing a lot of little chores if I wanted to convert it and put it to work. And of course, she understood the principle that put the power there in the first place. You might be able to actually put something up to actually go after the power, as I'm sure Mr. Tesla was contemplating, or even transmitting the power. I mean, you just never know. But oh lordy, it sure is fun to experiment. From the high desert in the middle of the night, which is just where we belong, this is Coast to Coast AM.
Talk with Art Bell. Call the wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5. And dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
Those are really serious drums, aren't they? How you doing, everybody? It's the weekend. It's a Saturday night. We're in open lines. We've got a fascinating guest coming up in this second hour. So remain where you are. Let us see what awaits on this Saturday night, shall we? First time caller line, you are on the air. Good evening, morning, hello? Whatever. Hi.
Hi.
What is your first name?
Patrizia.
Well, that's some name.
It's an Italian version of Patricia.
All right. Well, anyway, welcome to the program. And where are you, pray tell?
I'm living in Arizona.
Okay.
And I was just wondering if there was going to be a movie about the coming global superstorm.
You were, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it just so happens that there's this movie coming out called The Day After Tomorrow.
Okay.
Which was done by the same good people that did Independence Day. Mm-hmm. And, yes, it is based in part on our book, The Coming Global Superstorm. That would be myself and Whitley.
It's actually...
May 28th.
May 28th is when it comes out?
That's right. We're all very anxious, you know. We're dying to see what they have done with it. So
you haven't gotten a sneak preview?
Oh no.
You haven't?
No, I haven't seen it any more than anybody else has, which amounts to a trailer. But oh, what a trailer it is! Have you seen it?
Actually, I have. I cannot tell a lie.
Yeah, pretty cool, huh?
Oh, it looks really neat.
The hair on the back of your neck goes straight up when you see that, doesn't it?
I think I was just sitting there in the theater with my mouth open, going,
yeah.
"What?"
Yeah. May 28th.
All right. Well, thanks for taking my call, and we love your show. It's so good to hear your voice.
Take care, my dear.
See you later.
All right. Oh, by the way, on my cat, somebody writes to me, Sandy from Las Vegas writes, "Hey, Art, I'm quite sure Yeti is a Maine Coon cat, And yes, that's what Ramona says too. She's got a cat book, and that she looked it up. And Maine Coon cat is what he appears to be. He looks, he's got, oh, he's like a tiger. You know, he's got a mane, and he looks a lot like a tiger. And they are, you know, they're related, really. He is one cool cat, and I'm sorry. And I'm telling you that he came bounding into our yard out of nowhere, like he was released from the sky, not a speck of dirt or hair out of place, looking like a show cat when we got him. Skinny, yes, but a show cat. Perfect, you know, hair just perfect and all that. And he came bounding in and started doing twirls in the air. He was so happy to see us. He started doing twirls in the air out by the catnip. Now, that may have been an effect for, I don't know. Anyway, he was happy, and he's been here ever since. Very happy to be here. Quite an amazing cat. So, webcam photo. Hi there. Wildcard line, you're on the air.
Hey, Art. Daniel Sheehan, the attorney that, I guess, with Karen Silkwood, Iran-Contra, and founder of the Christic Institute, spoke at the UFO Congress in Laughlin on February 14th, and you referred to a PBS Nova show on, I think it was February 11th, talking about the changing position of the poles of the planet, the Earth's magnetic field.
Oh, they did one hell of a special on the field, yes.
Well, I didn't see it, so I'm going to ask you the questions about this. Daniel said something about from two poles, north and south. He said there'll be eight moving vortices. Is that correct?
Well, I'm not sure if that's right. I know the pole is always in motion. In fact, now, right now, I think the North Pole may be somewhere in, maybe in the Yukon or BC, or, you know, it's really drifted. I mean, it's amazing what's going on.
Well, you mentioned also about that could be part of the thing about the apocalypse scenarios where possibly two-thirds of humanity could be lost because of this new energy that will be coming down that people won't be ready for.
Well, it could produce very rapid climate changes or geologic changes. The Earth could rumble. Who the heck knows what would happen if the poles reverse? But it's, you know, it's quite a scenario.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I guess it's just, again, comes to a critical mass of some people getting their energy level up, and maybe we can keep, you said maybe 15 million at least, but at some point, it's going to be good because it's galactic cosmic energy coming into eight different points of the Earth, bathing the Earth, instead of just the North and South Pole.
You want to get an interesting point of view, let me share mine with you. I think it's interesting anyway. As you know, we've done a lot of experiments with this collective consciousness thing, and there is a big power there, a really big power. And it may be that if we, the world, get notice of a coming apocalypse and we have time to consider it in any way before it happens to us, I think that the power, perhaps, of collective consciousness, if applied uniformly or nearly uniformly, could have some, perhaps, effect on the outcome. And that may be the only power in the entire world capable of affecting that outcome. And that's a weird little belief that I've come to. So that shows you how I do believe in that power. And others, if you wish, you know, feel free to call it the power of prayer, whatever. But I actually think that it could have an effect, if it were orchestrated properly and worldwide, on the outcome of some potential cataclysm. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, Art. I'm doing a report for science class on whether or not to store nuclear waste near Yucca Mountain.
Oh, you are?
Yeah, and since you live near there, I was wondering what your thoughts are on the topic.
What are my thoughts on the topic? Yes, they're going to be storing that nuclear waste just over the hill, as it were, from where I'm located. They're not due to really get started for a long time yet, you know, years, maybe a decade, really. But, well, I'd rather it wasn't there.
Why?
Why?
Yeah.
Well, I guess for the same reason that you would be uncomfortable if your dad told you you were storing 100 cases of dynamite in your basement. Now, how would you sleep at night after that?
Well, but if they don't store it there, where do you think they should store it?
I don't have the slightest idea, and neither does our government.
Okay, well, it has to be stored somewhere.
Absolutely true. And where are you calling from?
I'm calling from upstate New York.
Upstate New York. Are you volunteering the upstate New York area as an area where it could be stored?
I would.
You would?
Yeah.
And so then maybe you really are it's okay to have like 100 crates of dynamite down in the basement.
Sure. I mean, if it leaked, it would kill a lot of people, and it has to be stored somewhere. So, and I wouldn't mind dying because of it. I'm going to die sometime.
You'd die for nuclear waste, huh?
Sure. I mean, for all I know, I could be killed in a car accident tomorrow.
Well, there is that, I suppose. All right. All right. Good enough. Thank you, and take care. Let's see who wrote this. This is pretty interesting. Sid in Ridgecrest, California. I have a report from the U.S. government, claim Sid. They already sent people through the time travel fog tunnel at the South Pole. It spits you out on the New Jersey Turnpike. Further studies have shown... Well, I can't read the rest of this, Sid. West of the Rockies, you're on the air.
Hey, Art. Hi.
Hi.
Okay, I've got a couple of things I'm going to try to weave together here so that they make sense on dowsing. I'm not a dowser, but I know a lot of dowsers. And
you believe it works?
I've seen it work.
Yeah.
So, I'm a show-me kid.
Yeah.
And I've seen it work, and sort of intuitively, I had a hunch that it had something to do with electricity, magnetism, and gravity.
Makes sense.
And I was in communication with a crop circle researcher named Paul Vigay. And I sort of started drawing these parallels, and I put it out to Paul and asked him if there was any evidence of water tables underneath some of the crop circles. And he said yes, and I said, okay, well, in that case, is there any evidence anywhere that could be reduced to a frequency equation and that possibly you could come up with some sort of musical equivalent? And he said, I don't know. Let me look into it. And the last I heard, in fact, that's what they were doing. They were pulling musical frequencies out of these crop circle formations that were located over water.
Everything has a vibratory rate. That's certainly true.
Yeah.
But the thing about dowsing that I'm curious about is there's also then got to be some connection to the mind of the dowser from all of this. Does there not?
I can't answer that question. I'm not a dowser, and I don't know. I would assume that a sensitivity to it.
I mean, there are some who can douse and some who cannot, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I can. I mean, I've never tried it, but I just, I don't believe I can. So, and that goes to the power of thought and what you were talking about earlier with the power of controlled exercise, common thought being able to shift things.
It may be the largest power in the universe, ultimately.
Hey, you know who's doing a really remarkable study on this right now? I don't know if you're familiar with the guy or not. His name is James Twyman.
At Princeton. I mean, there's all kinds of people now.
Yeah, well, Twyman's doing a worldwide experiment, and he's a well-known author, lecturer, peace advocate, but...
What kind of experiment is he doing?
He's doing consciousness. He's doing group prayer. He's using a number of models, one of which is just combined prayer efforts. There are others that he's doing something called the Mary Magdalene experiment that uses an ancient herb, the oil of an ancient herb called spikenard, that was a part of the anointing that's become so popular between Jesus and Mary prior to Christ's death.
Mm-hmm.
And he's using that oil to facilitate an experiment.
All right.
He uses group prayer, and he's having
remarkable success.
Results.
Yes. All right. Thank you very much. I know she's absolutely right. Of course, they are having remarkable success. Just remarkable. And it doesn't. Now, here's something that I know is troubling for a lot of people, but there does not seem to be a lot of difference, whether it's people concentrating for reason A, other than religious, or people concentrating for reason B, which is religious. The intent and the power, they all seem the same, whether it's from a religious point of view or a non-religious point of view. And I wouldn't begin to know what that means or says. And it doesn't necessarily say anything negative at all. It doesn't necessarily say that at all. It just may be a power, a comment on the power of the human brain, the ultimate power that we all don't even know we really have just yet. Or maybe it is religious. I don't have those answers. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Art?
Yes, sir.
This is Ken from Nashville.
Yes, sir.
My dad showed me how to do that dowsing with a couple metal rods. Is that what your wife uses?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you can use anything. I mean, even coat hangers, whatever.
Yeah, I can do it, so I guess anybody can do it. But I just wanted to ask you a question. Did you see the miniseries Taken?
It's funny. I didn't see it when it was on television. But the other day, we were in a local store, and the entire miniseries is on DVD, and we just bought it. So we're about to watch it.
Oh, I was going to ask you if the character that played the radio host was based on you.
Well, you know, yes, that's what people tell me. And I somehow, something interfered, I forget, we were on a trip or something when it was, you know, starting, and so we never got to see it. Now we have it on DVD. Everybody in the world wrote to me and said, yeah, that's you.
That's who I thought of when I saw it.
We shall see. I'll let you know after I watch, but I'm about to watch it because I've just got...
You'll like it. Thanks.
All right. Thank you very much. Yes. I've been told that by about a million people. That character was supposed to be me. It seems like taking the host of a paranormal kind of program of this sort and including them in a paranormal television show appears to have some weight in the minds of the producers and the writers and the directors of those shows. They use somebody like this a lot. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
This is Olin in Culver City.
Yes, Olin.
You said that you were going to be measuring electrical fields on your antenna from a helicopter. Now,
RF fields, radio frequency fields. In other words, we're going to be testing the model, you know, the computer model of what it says the antenna should be doing against the real world. And you do that by flying around in a helicopter with a receiver and seeing if the plots match.
Well, you interviewed a Professor James McCanny on September 20, 2003.
Yes.
And he said that hurricanes and tornadoes are powered by electric fields from the ionosphere.
Yes.
He said you could discharge the hurricane with tethered grounded barrage balloons near the coast in the path of the hurricane.
Yes, it's quite a theory, isn't it?
Yes, so... That might be, if you could review that, it might be related to that static electricity you're getting off of your antenna. It might be coming from the ionosphere.
Well, there could be a relationship in the energy that we're talking about here, whether it's the energy of a storm or that's being fed to a storm, or it's the energy that's always there. And believe me, I think there is energy always there. That's something we're going to, by the way, talk about really tomorrow night. I mean, the hunt for 0 point, we'll talk about tomorrow night. And I think that's, you know, it's all the same thing. Hi there, Wildcard Line, you're on the air.
Hey, Art.
Hey.
This is Blank. I'm calling from Providence, Rhode Island.
Yes, sir.
Listening to you on WPRO.
Right.
I have kind of a personal question to ask you. Not too personal, I hope. You can tell me to bug off if it is.
Okay.
Been listening to you for a long time. And I remember...
bug off.
What's that?
I'm kidding you. I'm kidding you. Go on.
Gotcha. Back in 95, 96, I remember you were talking about, and this, you were talking about homosexuality, and you were kind of talking about it, not in a judgmental way, certainly. You always, seem to be open to everything. But sort of distanced, like I just don't understand that. I don't see that. And I heard you a couple of weeks ago talking.
It's still true.
That's true.
Yeah, you know, of course, look, like a lot of people, as a heterosexual, I can't even contemplate. I can't even consider it in my mind. But you know what? That doesn't stop me from, you were referring now to a couple weeks ago when I said, you know what? I don't see who gay marriage is going to hurt. Meaning, me. I'm not threatened in my heterosexual marriage if homosexuals are allowed to get married. I mean, I just did sort of a logic talk with myself about it, and I thought, well, why not, I suppose? If they want to get married, then, hey.
Well, that was what I was calling to ask you about, actually, is where you came to, because that I heard you a couple of weeks ago, and I was wondering, you know, what went into that decision.
But well, it was all in the news, right? They started getting married up in San Francisco in droves, and so it was in the news. I was forced to think about it, and I just sat back and said, okay, what do I really think about this? And I don't think we ought to be passing constitutional amendments, and I don't think we ought to be, I think we ought to
be...
Yeah, I mean, doing what's right would seem to me to be okay. Yeah, maybe it'll be the end, you know, and the walls will come tumbling down, biblically speaking, or something. But I don't think so.
Yeah,
I think we'll make it through it.
Well, you've always been like really fair and open minded, and it's been a pleasure listening to you the whole time I have been. And
thank you.
Keep the good work going, Art.
I kind of pride myself on presenting different things to you all. Some things, you know, are pretty out there, and it's up to you as adults to make your own minds up about whether it's truth or trash.
That's it. That's what, you know, dragged me in at the start, and that's what's kept me listening for years and what will keep me listening.
And it'll keep me honest. I appreciate your call.
I appreciate talking to you.
Thank you, and have a good night. All right, coming up, Benjamin Baruch. This is an interesting guy, and he's up next on Coast to Coast AM. And yes, tonight we shall rock.
Can some people really find water dousing with a device?
Talk with Art Bell. Call the Wildcard Line at area code 775-727-1295. The first time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5. And dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
It is indeed, and the weekend, so the weekend version of Coast. How you all doing? My guest is a fellow named Benjamin Baruch. This is going to be one interesting story. Benjamin Baruch is a chartered financial analyst and a certified public accountant. His professional background includes money management for pension plans, high net worth individuals, you know, high end. Also the author of the underground bestseller, The Day of the Lord is at Hand. He wrote that in 1996 as a warning to America that a time of crisis was coming upon our nation, including a stock market collapse, currency collapse, terrorism, and ultimately, war. Now, this is a man who talked to God. This is a man who began doing what he was doing so he could play the stock market. That's my understanding, and we may get corrected on that. Benjamin is 47 years old. He sounds younger. In a moment, you'll hear his voice. This is really bound to be a strange interview, I think. Benjamin, welcome to the program.
Well, thank you, Art. It's good to be here.
Yeah, good to have you. You do have a very young-sounding voice. That's why I asked you how old you were when I talked to you just before the hour. It sounded to me like you were maybe in your 20s.
Well, I wish I was in my 20s. I wish I had the wisdom of the late 40s and the energy of the early 20s. It'd be a great combination.
Why do they never do go together. Why is that? We have youth and energy and stupidity, and then we have wisdom and a deteriorating body. It doesn't seem fair, does it?
It's not fair. It's one of the ironies of life.
You live with a few ironies of life yourself, don't you?
Yes, indeed, I do.
Huh. So tell us, you began all of this, didn't you, as some sort of, way to gain insight into how to play the market?
I wouldn't describe it as playing the market. I was managing money in the mid-1990s.
Okay.
And my clients included a company pension plan, a couple of endowment foundations.
Yeah, big time.
This was big time, and I was relatively new in this role. I had planned my entire career towards becoming a professional money manager, and
that is what you do though. You take their money and you decide where to invest it, right?
Yeah, I was picking stocks and advising clients on their allocation among asset classes and
I know your type. I talk to people like you, and so you were playing the market.
Yeah, okay, you could call it playing the market if you want.
Yeah. It's kind of a slang term, of course, but
right.
And I understand that you did it at a level that rises above such a saying. Did you do it well?
I did it very well for my first 2 years. I was running money in 95 and in 96, and I was 5,200 basis points ahead of the S&P 500. So I was in the top 1%.
How many?
5,200.
Holy mackerel.
So, yeah, I had to pick the right stocks
Start
of my career. I was on my way to becoming...
How do you get the rep? I mean, how do you get the rep of being so good? Where does that come from? When you pick winners, do you somehow advertise it? Do people start to realize who you are and that you're picking them right? Or how does it, you know?
Well, the way the game works with Wall Street is you have to have a 3-year track record. And then if you've got auditable performance for at least 3 years, you can open your own mutual fund and your track record is advertised. You know, this is the performance of the manager.
You get noticed, okay.
You get noticed.
Right.
So I was on the verge of putting together that type of track record.
Well, top 1%, that's...
pretty good.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Top 1%. Are you psychic?
No, I wouldn't describe myself as a psychic. Just picked some of the right stocks out of the gate and... had a little bit of beginner's luck, I guess. But in any event,
doesn't a lot of that, though, I mean, after you've analyzed everything, doesn't it depend on, to some degree, intuition? I mean, there's got to be a moment of...
Oh, I think intuition is a form of creative thinking.
Uh-huh.
I'm not sure that makes one a psychic as much.
And I'm not sure it doesn't.
Yeah, I mean, well, that's also true. I don't know.
It's an interesting line to even think about. If you examine people like yourself, that they're at the very top of what they do, or running very successful corporations, or whatever, you know, do they have something a little extra? That's a good question.
There probably is something extra going on.
Yeah.
Not sure.
And so you had how many years under your belt up there in the stratosphere of picking them right?
I had 2 years. I was a rookie in terms of running money.
Yep.
I was a seasoned professional as a financial advisor, but actually the responsibilities of directing assets, institutional assets, I was relatively new at.
Well, of course, if you can continue to pick at that kind of rate, you're headed for stardom, right?
I was on my way to stardom, or so
mm-hmm.
I thought.
Yes. So what the heck happened?
Well, what happened is by late 1996, the market's internal valuation measurements got to what were historic peaks.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about price earnings, multiple, dividend yield, all these other fundamental measurements of the stock market.
Everything was pumped up to the point where it was going to blow up.
Well, we were pumped up to the point where we had experienced a bear market in 1973 and a crash in 1929. But at the same time, I recognized what was happening with the international economy and the financial position of the United States relative to our trading partners, that we were actually headed into a bubble, and that the stock market was going to go far higher than it had ever gone before, and that there was no way to accurately measure when the bubble would burst. So I had a dilemma. I was running money for a company and for some endowment plans, and if I made the decision to sell stocks and get out of the market, and I was early by more than one or two quarters,
right,
I would in effect be fired.
Yeah.
You can't get out.
Yeah, I think I've got that. How much money were you handling?
It was a small sum, a little over $10
million. $10 million, well, so, yeah, you can't miss.
You can't get out early. But conversely, if you got out late, you could do some serious damage to your clients, to your customers.
Well, yeah, yeah. So, here you are, I guess, at this point, you sat down and you prayed to God, asking God if you ought to sell your stock. And God answered you? Is that what you're saying?
It's not exactly like that.
Well, it's written just exactly like that.
Well, to be more precise, in late 96, I knew we were ultimately going to face a major bear market because that's how Wall Street works. And I did begin to pray, seeking to hear from God on when to sell the stocks. But what I began to pray, and I actually did this every morning about 5 a.m. when I would get to work, I began to pray, Lord, show me the end of this matter.
Why, if I can be so bold, why would you imagine that God would respond to a prayer drifting up his way about whether or not to sell a stock? Now, I'm not saying that such prayer might not be okay, but you know, on the other hand, there might be others that you'd think might surge ahead of it, you know, like somebody's dying wife or something. And
well, I think God's capable of addressing all of the different issues.
Multitasking.
Yes, he's multitasked, definitely.
Well,
why was I so presumptuous to assume God would answer a prayer regarding the stock?
Absolutely, yes.
Well, for one very good reason. I had previously prayed about business matters and had, in fact, heard God answer me about issues relative to my business.
And all right. Is it worth asking how God responded to you?
Sure.
Is it just a resounding feeling of...
No. I can answer your question.
Oh, good.
And by way of my answer, I think your listeners might take me a little bit seriously, because it is rather unusual. I understand that people hear actually directly from God, but I had and have from time to time. Now, it's very rare. It doesn't happen very often, but on occasion I have heard specific answers.
I'll give you one example.
In what manner?
An audible voice.
An audible voice?
Yes.
Wow.
Audible voice, speaking to me clearly like I'm talking to you. And I had the experience of asking technical questions. I was working on a problem involving the tax law for one of my clients. This was in the 1980s.
Yes.
And I could not solve this problem. And the top lawyers were working on it, and they couldn't solve it. And I spent 2 weeks trying to find a solution, and there was none. And I finally decided, well, the only person I know that can figure this one out is God, so I'll ask him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Art, you can't imagine you heard from God when you're asking for the solution to a technical problem that no one can solve, like you could imagine that God said to go to lunch or not. You really have to hear or you have nothing. So I began to pray, and this was on the beginning of a weekend, a Friday night. I didn't hear anything all weekend. And I prayed probably 4 or 5 hours over this weekend. By Sunday night, I still had not heard any answer.
Yes.
Nothing but silence. I was, at this point, unable to sleep. I was so bothered by this problem.
Right.
And I was actually getting pretty upset. I mean, I was to the point of being in tears. And I'm crying out. Finally, I hear, have you considered you live in a community property state?
Huh?
I say, no, Lord, what does that mean? Then I hear, you're a smart kid. You can figure it out. Go work on it again. I run down to my office. I pull out the Internal Revenue Code, and I look at my problem, and I start thinking in the context of a community property state.
Yeah.
And I see the answer.
And the answer is?
Well, it's probably too complex for this call.
Well,
I mean, do you want me to go into it? It has to do with the attribution of ownership and how you define related parties under the Internal Revenue Code.
And how did this apply to the situation?
Well, if you live in a community property state and you've got a corporation and you have shareholders who are married,
yeah,
the wives own half of the stock,
right,
under community property law.
Right.
If those same shareholders are all partners in a partnership, the wives own 50% of the community interest in the partnership,
uh-huh,
but they are not partners. They just have a community interest in the partnership. As a result, the stock owned by the wives, which they own directly, is not counted in doing attribution to the partners. The result is you can shrink the number of shareholders that are subject to the related party rules under Code Section 267.
Well,
it allows you to take a large tax deduction that would otherwise be unavailable.
All right, I'm a little sorry I asked, but I'm not really, because it brings forth the fact that you really know what the heck you're talking about.
The amazing thing is, technically,
you know what you're talking about.
All right, I got to tell you, on this answer, which is technically correct, I talked to some of the top CPAs, and they told me you're crazy. And then I talked to the top tax attorneys, and they said, you're a genius. Nobody's ever thought of that before, but it's actually the truth. And the answer is, I didn't think of it. I was told that insight. And actually, hearing from God is something that...
How did they react to your revealing your source of information as God?
The company I was working for, the top people were Christians, and they were giving me these accolades about this great solution I had come up with, and I told them, I said, you know, actually, I can't take credit for this.
This came from God.
Yeah, I prayed about this, and God told me this answer.
All right. A couple of sort of, I don't know, technical questions about the way you hear God. When you heard his voice audibly,
yes,
give me a sense of, I mean, here you are, I presume, in a room somewhere, in your house maybe, because you were frantically praying. Did the voice come from all directions, or was there directionality to the voice?
There's definitely directionality.
Was it in front of you?
Well, there have been occasions where it's been in front, and there have been occasions where it's been behind.
Huh.
I'll give you one short example. I was in Israel traveling, and I was making a bus transfer.
Yes.
And I had my map, and the transfer city was right next to the main highway from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, and I thought, this will be easy to find. I'll just wait for the bus to go into the main freeway, and that'll be my transfer. And we drive under the freeway, and I get off the bus, and I'm thinking I'll just wait here for the next bus to come, and suddenly I hear behind me, "Benjamin, you're in the wrong place. Get back on the bus." Now, Art, I didn't know who was talking to me. I thought to myself, who would know my name here in a foreign country? I turn around to see who's talking, and there's nobody standing there.
Is it the same recognizable voice each time?
Absolutely.
It is.
Although, to be honest, there are times where I'm absolutely stunned.
Can you give me and the audience an idea of, is there anybody that it sounds like? Is it an accented voice? Is it a sort of an NBC Tonight kind of voice? I mean, what...
You know, that is so hard to answer. It would be like, how would somebody describe what your voice sounds like? Or my voice? You know, I don't know how to answer your question.
Maybe there would be somebody that this voice reminds you of, some public figure, or, you know, voices are very distinctive things, and maybe it reminded you of something.
Well, you know, it actually says in the scripture that my sheep know my voice. And when I read that,
yeah,
when I was a very young man, I thought, they sure do.
Yeah.
I hear you just fine.
All right. Have you ever been able to make inquiries of God?
Yes, I have.
Ask questions, get responses.
Yeah.
Okay, how long do some of these sessions go on where you have talked to God? For what kind of period of time have you had a chance to talk to God?
Oh, they're very brief. They don't seem to last very long. They're not long dialogues. They're more, you're on his agenda.
No, I've got that.
Not on mine.
But you typically, for example, get to ask one question or... You know, I'm trying to get a sense of the length. You say very short.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you wiggle in a question?
Well, you know, if you start out asking, it says, you know, if you knock and if you seek and if you ask, you're going to find. If you begin praying and calling on the name of the Lord and asking for the answer to a question,
mm-hmm. you'll get
He will find a way to get an answer to you. Most people experience his answer in the form of they get insight or they get circumstances will give them a sign. You know, Gideon put a fleece out. It's relatively rare for someone to actually hear the answer.
Sure.
I understand that.
And people will also say, how do you know you're talking to God? It's a pretty basic question. Some would say you're talking to some sort of a darker power. That could be trying to fool you. So it's an obvious question. How do you know you're talking to God?
Well, like I said, my sheep know my voice. That would be one test. The other is you've got to test everything by the scripture because there's clearly a lot of voices out there today. You know, you mentioned psychics. They're hearing something from some source.
Mm-hmm.
There's probably a lot of noise around us if we had the ears to hear it. And how do you know which voice is of God and which one is not? The only test I know is God's obviously going to tell the truth. It's obviously going to line up with the Holy Scriptures. And it's going to be wisdom and good, whatever he says. He's not going to tell you something crazy.
Well, now, I don't know. He told you quite a bit about the future of America, didn't he?
Well, he actually showed me the end of the matter. He answered me literally.
Uh-huh.
I saw.
Well, you know, I mean, we're talking about attacks with nuclear weapons and, you know, Judgment Day and all kinds of incredible stuff that you have seen, aren't we?
We are indeed.
All right, hold it right there. Benjamin Baruch is my guest. I'm Art Bell. Yeah.
to talk with Art Bell, call the Wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
Told you, be interesting. Benjamin Baruch, a lot of fast blasts just like this from Portage Lake, Arizona. Art, he's telling the truth. I've heard him too. No mistaking his voice. By the way, I'm not a Christian, so I don't have to read about him in a book. This is a stock market man, top 1%, picking, you know, for funds and stuff like that, who prays to God, gets answers about stock market, that sort of thing, and then. But then goes on to get all kinds of information, is shown all kinds of information about the future of our country. It is interesting. If you stay right there, it's about to unfold in front of your ears. Once again, Benjamin Baruch. Benjamin, welcome back.
Well, thank you, Art.
All right. I don't know. You sound like a pretty square guy to me, pretty straight up, and yet you talk to God, or God talks to you, more likely. But when you say, in fact, there was a fellow who wrote a book called Conversations with God, so you're sure not alone. There are a lot of people who say they talk to God, and so...
And God surely talks to...
Maybe it's true.
...many of us.
Yeah, maybe it's true. Maybe you've got to wonder if it's the same voice in a different language when it's Allah they're speaking to or praying to, or whether it's only God of the Christian Bible that answers like this out loud, or what do you think?
Well, that's a complex subject, but let me just share one other example with you. I was speaking at a local church a year or so ago, and number of young people had been brought to hear me talk about my book, and I was giving them a summary of the material that's in it, and talking about the attack that's coming on the country and the financial collapse.
Yeah, we're about to get to all that.
And so on. And, you know, they were looking at me with kind of a smirk on their face, and, you know, I could tell they thought I was kind of a goofball.
Well, you got to admit, Benjamin,
and,
there's there are going to be people that are going to react that way. I mean,
I totally understand, okay. and that's reasonable. And so I could tell the crowd was sort of not taking me very seriously. And then all of a sudden, the Spirit of God came upon me, and I heard the Lord speak, "I'll take this conversation from here." And I thought, well, that's good. I don't really know what to say anyway. The subject, of course, immediately changed, and now,
was this coming from your mouth?
No, I heard that in my ears. I'll take the conversation from here.
Okay.
And then I changed. Coming out of me, the subject changed, and I said, "The Lord is ready to bring forth the first four judgments. They are ready to break forth upon you even now." And I walked into the crowd, got right in the face of one of the young men, and I grabbed him by the arm, my right hand. I grabbed him by the shoulder, and I started hitting him on the shoulder, saying, "It's going to be just like your arm, brother. The four judgments are coming forth just like on your arm."
At this point, wasn't the teacher getting worried?
Well, this young man that was standing there turned and ran out of this church, and a friend ran after him, and I just kept on talking. 5 minutes later, the friend came back, interrupted me. "How did you know about his arm?" I forgot he'd been saying this, and I said, "Excuse me, I don't know what you're talking about."
Yes?
He said, "You said the four judgments are ready to begin. It would be just like his arm. How did you know?" I could then see this in my mind. I remember doing this. I said, "Oh, yeah, I did say that. But I don't know anything about his arm." Well, he's sitting in his car so scared he can't drive. He wants to know, "How does this guy know about my arm? I've never seen this guy before."
What about his arm?
He had a tattoo of the four horsemen of the Book of Revelations under his jacket on his arm. Those are the four judgments ready to come forth. Suddenly fear came on that crowd, Art. All those smirky faces
got rather long.
And from the back of the auditorium, some young man stood up, started waving his hand, and said, I'm a Navy SEAL. I've been in the military 8 years. He broke down weeping as he shouted, and everything this man said is true.
Yeah.
And, of course,
Southern Baptists?
Well, no, it's just a non-denominational church.
That's pretty active stuff for non-denominational.
Well, you know, they didn't take me seriously until...
Well, I know, but I'm talking about just the whole presentation is, you know, dramatic in the mindset of the Baptists.
Right, but this just happened. I've never told anybody that something is going to happen just like on their arm. I mean, it's a rather insane comment, really. Unless, of course, you have a tattoo of the picture of exactly what's coming to pass.
Yeah.
Then it's perfect. But this guy had a jacket on, right? You know, and it wasn't me that was moved to say that.
All right.
Anyway.
Let's now transition, since it's such serious news.
Sure.
To how do you get from a conversation, answered prayers with regard to questions, to being shown an image of the future of our country?
Well, I began praying in late 96, and I didn't hear anything for almost a year. And I actually, my main client was a large corporation, and there was a investment committee that I reported to on the status of the pension plan, and every 2 weeks I would have to report on activities and performance.
Mm-hmm.
And I told these men I was praying and going to ask God on when we should begin to sell our stocks. And they thought, well, that's interesting, but, you know, why not?
Were they Christians too?
Yes, they were, but they weren't people that had ever experienced hearing directly, although they knew that I had previously.
Then they must have been concerned you hadn't heard from him in about a year.
No, I told them I'm just going to sit here and wait, and it doesn't really matter how long, you know.
Well, to their money, though, it might.
Well, no, I just figured God would speak by the time it was necessary that we hear from him, and remain long the market.
Yeah.
So I prayed literally every day for almost a year, and then I had my 40th birthday. And shortly after my 40th birthday, I heard from the Lord. And I went back into my committee and I said, well, I heard from the Lord. And they said, oh, you did? Mm-hmm. What did he say?
Mm-hmm.
Did he say to sell the stocks? And I said, no, not exactly. Actually, he didn't even mention the stock market. But from what he showed me and what he said to me, I think it's safe to assume you could sell everything. We're in trouble. And, of course, that wasn't a real popular message, Art, as I'm sure you can imagine.
No. Now you're sounding a little like Major Ed Dames. But that's all right. Let's see what you got. You were shown the future of America, and so what were you shown, and in what manner did it come to you? People will want to know that.
Well, I was shown through insight and through some words that were shared with me that America, the church, the nation, and the world were going to come under judgment. And that the judgment, the end time judgment of the nations of the earth was going to begin in the United States.
Hmm.
That we were number one. We were the top nation, and God's judgment actually begins with us.
Meaning we are about to be dealt the harshest...
No, I don't think it's going to be the harshest immediately. I think, you know, if you look at the way God deals with people and the way he deals with nations, he gets successively more stern or more forceful because he's looking to create a response. He's not trying to bring judgment for the sake of judgment alone. He's trying to wake up a nation. He's trying to awaken a people who've, maybe their hearts have grown hard and their ears have grown dull.
Well, this doesn't sound like the final judgment, because it isn't written that way. It's not like, here's a warning for y'all?
Oh, it's definitely a warning, and it's definitely going to lead to the last day's final judgments, but America's judgment actually precedes.
Well, if yes, but I guess what I'm saying is if Armageddon is inevitable, as the Bible describes, then what use any sort of warning, since it's predestined? What's the point of a warning?
Well, I think the point of the warning is for our individual lives, we can
save our souls.
Well, we can save our souls. We can probably save our necks, too.
Well, that would imply that we could intervene in what otherwise will be an apocalypse, Armageddon.
Well, there's no doubt that the Battle of Armageddon is coming at some point in time.
Yes.
But God also deals on an individual level with each person on this planet, and whether we come under judgment or pass from judgment to life is a function of the decisions that we make uniquely. So for God to issue his warning, and if we then take notice and begin to move in the right directions based on our wisdom and the light that we have, I think that will change the ultimate outcome in our individual lives.
You do. See, that's the part that I don't get. Mm-hmm. So you're saying it could change for us individually, but that the larger apocalypse or Armageddon will still occur.
I believe, yeah, that's correct. The larger apocalypse is
going to happen anyway.
Is going to happen whether we individually are judged in that or whether we are among the few that are counted worthy to escape is a function of how we behave and how we respond. So it's not without hope. And
all right, exactly what is going to happen?
You want to know exactly what's going to happen?
Well, yes, actually I do.
Okay. This is based on my limited insight, and I'm not infallible, and so my order or my understanding could be somewhat off. And I don't think for a minute, because I heard from God, that I therefore even understand precisely what he meant, let alone is the rest of my insight and understanding somehow inspired. I'm just a man just like you.
Okay.
Okay?
All right.
But based on my insight, what is going to happen?
Standard disclaimer for a conversation with God there.
Yeah, that's right.
All right.
What's going to happen is America is described in Bible prophecy as an eagle. An eagle who has built her nest in the stars, much like we built our space station in the stars.
Mm-hmm.
The eagle's wings are plucked. America is judged before the final tribulation period described in the prophetic writings.
Yeah, well,
this judgment will come in several ways.
Right. If you wouldn't mind, I want to know what you actually saw.
Okay, what did I actually see?
More than what the Bible says is going to happen. What did you see?
What I actually saw was a Holocaust taking place in this country. I was standing in my living room, and I was literally caught up, if you will, into the spirit. It was more than a vision, Art, because I was standing in the future.
Okay, yeah, that's what I want. I want your description. You're standing in the future, seeing what?
I was actually in a concentration camp watching people, families be separated, being processed into a civilian concentration camp.
So you see a future of concentration camps in the United States?
That will come, yes. I also saw nuclear bombs detonated. I saw a nuclear war coming in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
Actually,
do you think you actually saw nuclear war, or do you think you saw terrorist acts?
No, what I saw was probably 100 megaton size nuclear detonations, and I also saw the fallout coming down out of the sky, and I was catching it in my hands in this vision that I had. And I described it to a friend of mine, Jeffrey Nyquist, who knows quite a bit about a lot of this stuff. And he asked me, Billy, have you ever seen fallout before? I said, no, I haven't attended any nuclear detonations. I've never seen fallout. Well, you've described it perfectly. It's thick. It's like chipped paint. It's whitish, grayish, with swirls of yellow and brown colors mixed in.
Hmm.
And these bombings came after I saw four.
West of the Rockies, call toll-free 1-800-618-8255.
1,001.
Right. What I'm going to do is omit the names of the airlines. So there's no point in giving out two major U.S. airlines. Leave it at that.
The same ones that were involved in...
Oh, yeah, leave it at that. Yeah.
Yeah.
So... So you saw the U.S. Hit with 100 megaton bombs and people dying in vast numbers, I suppose.
Well, I didn't see that part, no, but obviously if it were that we were hit with large nuclear weapons, yeah, I would assume there'd be massive casualties, unfortunately.
All right. Any sense of when all of this unfolds? I mean, you know, I talked to... remote viewers who claim to be able to, you know, look into the future and tell about this sort of thing. Is there any way that you have an understanding of how quickly this sort of thing is going to actually happen? The bombs falling, for example.
I would be venturing a guess as to timing, Art. My sense would be that it's in the next in the years that are ahead of us. It's not 100 years off. I would venture the guess that it's within the next 10 years.
Hmm.
But that would be my guess. And actually, if you look at the biblical record, God gave Jeremiah insight into a judgment that would come in his lifetime, but it didn't come for 30 years. And at one point, he laments, "Have you deceived me? Nothing's happened. I gave this warning, and life went on." And so this, you know, that may be the case here as well. We might have 10, 20 more years. I frankly don't know.
Hmm. What do you know about demons? If you hear from God, then certainly there probably are demons, like described in the Bible, aren't there?
Oh, there clearly are demons, as described in the Bible.
Okay.
What would you like to know about them?
What do I want to know about demons? That's an interesting question. What do I want to know about demons? I want to know, do they serve their master Lucifer, as most of us commonly think?
My understanding is yes, they do, and under fear as well.
You mean they themselves fear Lucifer?
Yes, they fear.
And so they do his nasty little bidding here on Earth.
Yeah, I think they probably do it because their own nature is corrupted to the point that they are the embodiment of evil. But yes, there is a demonic host that's trying to interfere with humanity,
okay,
as much as there's an angelic host that's trying to shepherd us and protect us.
Okay, well, do the demons do things like drive airplanes into buildings? I mean, are they part of it, or do they drive it?
I think the demons drive the men to make sinful and evil decisions, but ultimately human beings have to take responsibility. You know, the demons obviously were involved with Adolf Hitler.
So
no question.
You're saying then that, well, okay.
And,
sure.
And certainly the demonic is inspiring this global terrorism that is occurring, which is an unspeakable evil. Clearly that's demonic. But did the demons do it directly? No. Some human being had to make the decision to commit an atrocity. But I believe there was probably a demonic element that was operating in the life of the people that made those insane decisions.
You know what? I want to circle back. We've got a break coming up, and so there's something I want you to think about for me, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And that has to do with the question I asked you about God and perhaps... Allah, or Buddha, or some of the other great recognized religions of the world, and whether the devotees of those religions, when they pray, get answers from, the equivalent in a different language, or something like that. Or is it just our God that speaks?
I'm
Can some...
All right, for the sake of time, in a moment I'm going to ask Benjamin a series of fairly quick questions, but I do want to jump right back to where I said I was going to go, Benjamin, and it is an important question, I think, and that is, if a Buddhist prays to hear from Buddha on something, or to Allah, or to whoever, there are so many that are worshipped by millions. And as well as, you know, not just Christians. So, Benjamin, do you think that these people get answers, or do only Christians get answers?
Well, that's a profound question, and I want to answer it clearly and directly, but I want to also correct your comment regarding the website. Our website's back up. Yeah, we were.
Oh, yeah, when did it get back up? Because it crashed before the show.
It crashed before the show. We had to reroute it through a server that could handle higher volumes.
But yes.
The website, thedayoftheLordisathand.com,
is up.
Back up.
It is back up.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Well, anyway.
Good. Well, we can thank my internet
yes.
team. Who...
Yes, and whoever else might have anything to do with it.
Right. Uh-huh. A couple of people did some hard, fast work.
You didn't have a fast word with someone, did you?
No.
All right. Okay.
Some capable assistance.
Yeah. All right, back to the profound question.
Back to your question. Well, clearly there are a lot of voices and there are a lot of sources for information out there. I would say when a Buddhist or somebody from some other faith prays to their God,
mm-hmm.
they may very well hear an answer or have some type of interaction or response from their God, but their God is not God.
How can that be, though?
Well, it's simple.
But wait, Benjamin, according to every Christian I've ever talked to, Christianity is the only true religion, period, and the others are not true. They have to be false, according to strict doctrine, right?
Well, I would agree with that, yes.
You would?
Absolutely.
Then
there's only one way.
Then where are they getting these answers?
From the spirit world. From the other spirit beings that are out there walking around masquerading.
So then you're telling me they're not really hearing from Buddha.
They're hearing from their God, just not my God. They're hearing from a God.
Well,
hearing from
I
an
know,
angel.
You're,
that
saying, you're then saying there are other gods.
Sure. There are other spirit beings that would masquerade as the king of the universe.
Keyword, masquerade. So you're saying they're not real gods?
No. There's only one God.
Only one God?
Yes.
God of the Bible?
Christian Absolutely.
God. Okay.
No question.
All right.
And the reason why that is, Art, is that only those who are born of the light can bear witness to the truth, but in fact there are two cities. There's a Zion and there's Babylon. And through the course of human history, there are two rivers that have been running. There's a river of life with living water.
Are we the modern Babylon?
Absolutely.
We
part
are.
Of end time Babylon.
Yeah, great.
And I can explain that to you
well,
in detail.
Well, I probably understand it without your doing so. What are UFOs? What do you think UFOs are?
I think very clearly UFOs are alien. They are definitely there. But what's been demonstrated by a number of the scientists that have studied the UFO phenomenon is they are actually not physical objects. They've defied the laws of physics in terms of the things that have been observed by radar and by other official agencies. I think they are a projection from another dimension, and I think they're part of the deception of this final hour.
And Benjamin, what do you, Benjamin Brook, think of the people that say, yes, they're aliens. You're certainly right about that.
They're not actually from my neighborhood.
That's right. They're from another star system or whatever. But they were, in fact, our genetic architects. They designed us, not that which we call God.
Well, that's certainly the claim. I find that to be absurd.
Absurd.
Absolutely.
Okie doke. The Middle East. The Middle East, of course, is
sort of center court.
Oh, you betcha. Biblically, in every other way, it's supposed to begin there. The whole thing is supposed to begin there. Is that where we're headed right now? There are sort of peace talks on and off and blown up frequently and then on again. And so where do you think that's going?
Well, I think they're going to continue to wrestle with the issue of negotiating a settlement or a peaceful resolution to the Middle East conflict. But as I was going to make the point, there are really two seeds, if you will, on this planet. There's the seed of the serpent and the seed of the woman. And 6,000 years of warfare has proved that, no, we can't just all get along. There's a reason we've been at war for 6,000 years. The reason is ultimately spiritual. Sons of light and sons of darkness are never going to sit down and have a successful peace negotiation.
No, never.
It's never going to happen.
So it's
a war. 6,000 years of history backs me up.
It's a war to the absolute end.
Unfortunately.
And we are the pawns, more or less. And the prizes in the war?
Well, I think the prize is truth. I wouldn't say we're pawns, Art.
No?
No.
Well, I don't know. Sometimes I feel that way, Benjamin. If you read the Bible and the way it will all end, it is as though we can do nothing to prevent it. What about on a personal level? When this is visited on America and the concentration camps are here and the atomic bombs are falling, the hydrogen bombs,
mm-hmm.
and death and destruction is wrought, what can a single person do? Anything at all?
I think each of us has a choice, and God gives us choices throughout our life.
Well, would you save your butt by moving to Europe or the Orient or, I don't know, somewhere where the apocalypse is not?
Well, based on my understanding, the judgment that's going to begin here in America will ultimately encompass the whole earth. So the first and foremost thing to do to save your butt, as you say,
yeah.
is to get right with God, which, you know, I would suggest people get their Bibles out and begin to
Yep, but that
pray.
Implies that we're going to stay here and take the ride. Now, you know, it's maybe an impertinent question, but I'm going to ask anyway. If somebody really thought this was coming down, why not go to Europe?
Well, I think that's certainly a feasible
plan?
Response. Art, you recall the Y2K phenomenon?
Of course.
And you remember the hysteria at the time?
Yes,
you remember the several agencies of the federal government released reports indicated there may be actually some real problems with Y2K.
Yeah, that's
remember
right.
the Naval report?
They spent billions of dollars on preventing it, and
sure.
you know, once the panic began, and so they really did prevent it. Not a lot of people
well,
know that.
Yeah, that's probably true. There was a lot of money spent, but you know, at the same time, they knew that it was under control. Yet, all over the United States, the cities and the state governments and the federal government were building underground command and control bunkers for a problem that didn't exist. In terms of Y2K, but they need those bunkers for something else. I would suggest to you and to our listeners that the underground bunkers that were built for Y2K,
yes.
that was a bit of a cover story, and
yes.
the reason why we have underground command and control bunkers in all of our cities is they know something they're not telling us about.
Mm-hmm. And what do you imagine that to be?
I think that the people who have insight recognize we are headed for war. Matter of fact, actually, we're already in a war, if you take the statements of our president literally. We're in a war against terrorism.
We are.
And
I said it earlier myself. Look at what just happened in Spain. And as far as I'm concerned,
that was the same event.
We must go and we must kill these people.
Well, then we don't have a choice. They started the war.
Yeah.
And, you know, the events in Spain were 911 days following September 11th.
I've seen a number of things on the Internet floating around about that. So it really is true. It was 911 days?
Well, that's what I've understood. I didn't check
that's
the math.
That's going around on the Internet. I haven't checked it either. But, yeah, I know.
I'm not sure it's meaningful, but it wouldn't surprise me at the same time. But in any event, when you look at the states that sponsor terrorism, you know, and let's be honest here and not pretend that, you know, the world is a friendly place. There are nations that are not pro-American. And yeah, some of them are major trading partners.
One of them is Saudi Arabia.
Oh, absolutely.
In fact, you know, there is a number of lawsuits that are looking straight to Saudi Arabia for recovering money and damages for what happened on 9/11. And you can bet that the Saudis had a financial hand, if not more, in the middle of that whole damn thing. So,
well, and if you go back over the history of the last 40 years, the Communist Alliance, the Russians, the Red Chinese, they have been the allies of these Arab states that have been sponsoring terrorism. And to think that that's all changed.
And who do you think we go to war with? Have you given that any thought?
Ultimately,
yes.
It's going to be an alliance of many nations. I think we're looking at the Russians, the Chinese, the Nicaraguans, the Cubans, the Libyans, the Iranians. You know, the list goes on. I could just
that
keep
is a
talking.
Pretty good list, actually. Yeah, you know,
I think it would be basically the communist and Muslim Arab alliance.
Hmm.
And unfortunately, we're being painted as the bad guys in many corners of the world today.
Yeah. And actually, one can understand a case for how we are painted to be the bad guys, the colonialists, the, you know,
exactly.
The big bullies on the block and all the rest of that. And so you can sort of try and see it from their point of view, but even if you struggle to try to be fair like that, we still have to go kill these radicals before they kill us, and they have every intent to try and kill us. I mean, they're proving that
absolutely.
Again and again. They're
true.
Just going to kill people until they are killed. So, end of that discussion.
Well, yeah, we have to stop them because they're not going to stop, and there is not a negotiated outcome with the terrorist. It's just not going to happen.
I absolutely agree with you. I mean, that's all there is to it. They've got to die. And so moving on from there, I want to understand a little bit of how you were in the market, you were managing the money for these funds, and then apparently at some point your ability to successfully do this waned or stopped. Was it when you began talking with God or somewhere after the first conversations?
You want to know what happened next? Is that the question?
I guess that'd be another way of putting it, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Well, as I mentioned, I went back to my committee and I said, well, I've heard from the Lord. And they said, oh, really? And I shared the message and they said, let's not tell anybody about this right away.
Hmm.
Let's pray about it.
Really?
And I thought, well, that's a good idea. Okay, fine, let's pray about it. And
The message again being, folks, if you just tuned in, that
God was about to judge the church in America.
And you told them they should just go ahead and sell because it's
that was being a little bit...
Right. But the bottom line was, look, it really doesn't make a heck of a lot of difference one way or the other because Judgment Day is about upon us, so who cares?
That what's coming is so much bigger than this footnote of what's
exactly.
The rate of return on your investment portfolio.
Yes, yes.
It's really a question of whether you're going to live or die.
So they suggest not telling anybody about this and praying on it for a bit, and
yes.
So that's what you did.
That's what I did.
And?
And about a little over a week went by, and it was time for me to make my annual presentation to the various operating divisions for this company
right.
On the results of the retirement program.
Huh.
And so I was speaking to one of the regional offices, and I do a one-hour program on the benefit plans. And Art, as I was wrapping up this meeting, I hear from the back of the room, I wish to speak to this people. And I think to myself,
uh-oh.
Why did God say this people?
By the way, do you think God has a sense of humor at all?
Absolutely.
Oh, there has been some indication that he does.
Clearly.
Uh-huh.
Hey, obviously he must. Half of what goes on down here is
pretty hilarious, really. Yeah, if he's orchestrating all this, he definitely has a sense of humor.
No question.
And as well as some other senses.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, actually, to be honest with you, if you imagine that what goes on down here, it really is orchestrated by God, then it just makes you wonder about God altogether.
Well, I wouldn't say orchestrated as if this was his perfect plan.
Well, obviously not.
Yeah, clearly not.
But if orchestrated in detail, if we are macro-managed and our futures are set in stone, well, then there's this free will thing, right? So.
Well, that's a whole other show, probably.
Well, probably, but it does begin to mix in there, and so.
Definitely.
But then there also might be this master plan in which we're all kind of puppets, and that's the one where, that's one where you start asking all these really hard questions about, you know, the nature of God. If what's going on down here is reflective of God's will, well then.
No, it's actually reflective of man's rebellion. See, we got 5-6 billion people that all want to be God in various degrees. And
yeah.
This is the consequence of everybody just doing their own thing. Osama bin Laden wants to do his thing. You want to do your thing. But we keep kind of running into each other in what's called conflict. We've had 6,000 years of it. It hasn't really worked out very well. I wouldn't place the blame for this mess at God's doorstep.
You wouldn't.
No, I don't think that's right, Art. I think humanity chose this outcome. God merely wrote in his prophetic writings what he knew we would ultimately choose. If anything, I would say he put a lid or a limit on the insanity.
But
or we would have probably done ourselves in far sooner.
Yeah, but gosh darn it, Benjamin, Then God has created us knowing that he created a failure, right?
Well, you know, that's a very interesting philosophical question. Yeah, I could see the point. At the same time, God created us knowing that he himself was the answer. Maybe we are failures, but there is someone who's above and greater and it's him that's going to be glorified.
But that's kind of still a perverted sense of humor. You'll have to pardon my venturing into these areas, but it's a perverted sense of humor if he created us to fail.
I think he created us to be redeemed. I mean, yes, clearly mankind fell, and I would call that a failure, but the ultimate destiny for humanity is redemption.
All right. Benjamin, I'm going to open the phone lines here in a second.
Sure.
I'm curious. What do you think will happen when I do? What do you expect to get?
Well, I think we will get either very positive or very negative phone calls.
Well, you know, that's a safe bet.
I'm also hoping we can talk a little bit about the economy and the stock market and
my favorite stuff.
Because okay. I'm prepared to educate your listening audience.
All right. All right, well, hey, we're here to be educated. It's what it's all about, so we'll talk about it. Sure, why not? We'll talk about his views on the economy, where America is right now, what's happening with all the jobs that really aren't happening. Have you seen the numbers? They're pretty depressing. From the high desert, middle of the night, this is Coast to Coast AM, and I'm Art Bell. It's one whale of a night.
Just like a river running through the air of the cat.
To talk with Art Bell, call the Wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
Benjamin Baruch is my guest, and he talks to God. God talks to Benjamin. And they have talked of stock market things. They have talked of many things, including the future of America, which is clearly apocalyptic. He'll be right back. And so will I, but it's just impossible to cut off sacks that good. An obvious question to Benjamin would be, why you, Benjamin? Why would God pick you? But the obvious answer already entwined within the interview is that God speaks not just with Benjamin, but apparently anybody who asks sufficiently well. Benjamin, you're back. Give me an overview then, if you would, fairly quickly, of the state of the economy. If you're advising on stock market buys now, where you might advise to buy or sell, and what you think's going on with our economy. Jobs are not part of this apparent resuscitation of the economy so far, a very troubling aspect to it. What do you think?
Well, it's difficult to give a quick overview that would be sufficient to cover a comprehensive understanding, but in a nutshell, we are experiencing a reflation of the debt bubble, and the bubble has moved from the stock market to the housing market. There are no real jobs being created in America. I read a statistic recently that 60% or more of the new jobs that were created in the last 2 years have been filled by illegal immigrants at basic minimum wages. There's virtually no high-income job creation, and one of the reasons is we are exporting our manufacturing base, and now we're exporting a large number of white-collar jobs.
All of that's true. Absolutely true. Back up a little bit, and we'll take our time with a couple of things. One is the housing bubble. There are homes in California right now, Benjamin, that here where I live might cost $100,000, and in California they cost $400,000. So there is a gigantic housing bubble going on. Is it about to burst?
There's indications that national demand is slowing. Inside California itself, there's a supply constraint that's pushed prices to unreasonable levels. The frightening statistic is that the percent of new home buyers using adjustable rate mortgages is now above 70%. And with record low fixed rates, people are moving to adjustables to afford the price shock. Historically, ARMs, or adjustable rate mortgages, were used when interest rates began to go up in order to allow people to continue to buy the homes. But in today's marketplace, people have gone to the adjustables out of sticker shock. They're a shock absorber for the price itself, which won't leave us any slack, if you will, in the event or when interest rates finally do begin to rise again. I think there's no question we're in a housing bubble. In the area where I live, basic tract housing is $800,000. With 2% property taxes, it's a $16,000 a year tax to own a home. And that doesn't count the payment. Very few people make that kind of money.
That's right. So how close are we to all this bursting?
I would think once we get past the election, we're going to see the slide back down into into the recession, and you can call it whatever you want. We've witnessed over $1 trillion of stimulus being thrown at the U.S. economy.
Mm-hmm.
And as Warren Buffett said recently, give me $1 trillion and I'll show you a good time. And what he meant by that was, we spent the trillion, I hope you enjoyed it.
Hmm.
Just to give you a sense of where the money went, in the last 12 months, consumer spending contributed to around $260 billion of gross domestic product growth, or GDP growth. We have a $500 billion trade deficit that I'll discuss in further detail. And with the consumers borrowing approximately $1.2 trillion on all of their assets in the last 12 months, all we witnessed in terms of economic growth was $260 billion in additions to GDP. $500 billion leaked out of the country through the trade deficit, and the difference, about $400 billion, apparently was used for debt service to make the payments on all the money we borrowed last year. You cannot create perpetual wealth by geometric debt additions, and that is exactly what's happening to the United States.
Do you tell the people you're trying to manage money for all this stuff?
Absolutely.
I'd be derelict
in my duty if I didn't.
Okay.
Absolutely.
You would think, after hearing all this, there'd be nobody willing to sail a penny toward any investment.
There's always assets that rise in value relative to those that fall. You've heard it said, no doubt, they don't ring a bell at the top in the stock market.
Yeah.
Well, in September of 2000, I sent a letter to all my clients saying, I'm ringing the bell. And
this was a message from God, right?
Well, yes, actually, God did ultimately speak to me about the stock market in September of 2000 and told me to sell. And so I sent a letter to all my clients. And though the economic signs were flashing currently.
This is going to be hard, Benjamin. It's going to be hard. But here we go. Okay, fine. So God told you to sell these stocks, which certainly is a great benefit for your clients. They make money. But the flip side of the coin is, somewhere out there, there's somebody else holding stock, which is now worth less because you just sold those stocks.
No, that's not correct, Art.
It isn't?
No, not at all. You cannot take money out of the market any more than you can put money in the market.
What do you mean by that?
Well, when one individual is buying stock, the money is merely passing to someone who is selling. General Electric, for example, just had a large secondary offering. People bought the new GE stock. The cash went into General Electric's bank account from the bank account of the investors. The money didn't go into the market, per se. There is no cash.
Well, what I'm saying is, though, when your clients would sell their stocks.
But that isn't what drove the price down.
But selling drives down a price.
No.
In a larger way, it does. Yes.
Well, my clients are a small percent of the total volume that's occurring on the exchange.
Yeah, but I'm thinking of this like God would think about it. In other words, why would God involve himself in the doggone stock market anyway? I mean,
why would he involve himself in any of the day-to-day affairs of mankind?
Fair enough. Yeah, that's fair enough. All right, look, here's what I want to do. Anyway, obviously you have a lot of views on the economy, but I want to...
I wanted to make a couple of points very clear, and I'll try to be brief.
All right, do that.
Point number one, the so-called recovery that we are experiencing is a statistical hoax.
Mm.
It's an illusion. It really belongs in a Las Vegas magic show rather than on Wall Street. And how is the illusion created? I want to explain to our viewers the sleight of hand that the magicians are using inside these government agencies.
Sure, go ahead.
Publishing this garbage economic data.
Fire away.
In the mid-1990s, we began to change the way we calculated our economic data for what was called quality adjustments. They use a fancy term. It's called hedonic deflation. It means, essentially, quality adjustments. And here's an example of this sleight of hand. In impact on the economic data that's released in this country. Take computer production as an example.
Okay.
From 2002, the first quarter, until third quarter of 2003, the official data for computer production in this country showed an increase of $128 billion, or roughly 49-50% increase.
Okay.
This number went into our GDP and our national productivity and our national income data. The vast majority of that $128 billion, the true increase in real dollars was only $16 billion. The imaginary increase was $112 billion, and that's because, Art, the computers were faster. Therefore, even though we only sold $12 billion more in computers, because the computers are faster, we're going to count it as $128 billion. Well, that so-called gimmickry is going into all of our economic data.
I think most people believe that our government feeds us a bunch of absolute trash when it comes to statistics like unemployment doesn't include those who have just, you know, been employed
so
long
that
they gave up. Because
there are no jobs.
Hell with this, I'm never going to get a job, I'll stay home.
Right, that means you're no longer unemployed. Congratulations.
Yeah, so you're no longer on the unemployed list, which is crazy.
Or how about consumer price inflation? Have any of our listeners seen prices going up lately? For
how about gasoline?
Yeah, gasoline's only worth.
Yeah, prices are going up, yes.
Prices are going up.
We have noticed.
We have no inflation.
Yes, we have noticed.
Yeah, so this statistical chicanery is occurring in all facets. Take the other measure of inflation, the producer price index. The government refused to release the number the last 2 months, Art, because they haven't figured out how to cook the books. So they literally will not release the PPI number. Now, that's hilarious.
Did they,
they've got to go back and work on the math.
Yeah, did they put that in a memo somewhere?
This was officially announced when they're supposed to release this data every month, and they came out and said, well, we're working on revising the calculation. We just don't understand the answer we're getting right now.
Okay, that's interesting.
So what we've got is a bubble economy where this country is going into debt at rates that are unprecedented.
Uh-huh.
Take the trade deficit. That's just one of our debts that's growing. Right now it's $500 billion a year.
All right.
I want to put that number into perspective for our listeners.
Growing at $500 billion a year, is that right?
The trade deficit is running at a rate of $500 billion a year,
right,
which means we're issuing debt internationally in an amount of $1.3 billion a day.
I think I get the picture. May I ask you this? Do you know, either from your own knowledge or imparted directly from God, when this is going to implode?
Well, traditionally, when a nation's trade deficit reached 5% of their economy, the size of their economy,
yes,
it imploded. We are at that level right now in the United States.
Right.
However, we're in the unique position of having been the leading economic power and the dollar being the reserve currency for the world. So we can probably press our luck a little bit further, but the $500 billion deficit that we're financing every year,
yes,
every day,
yes,
it is absorbing 85% of the world's savings. Now, Art, think about it. The United States is borrowing 85% of all the money saved on the planet so that we can continue to drive our SUVs and buy their oil and their electronics and their fancy cars. And so we can float it all on more and more credit cards every year. How long do you think this will continue?
I don't know.
Clearly, there's a day of reckoning coming.
You're the expert, and that's what we've got you here for. How close is that day of reckoning? I mean, one day.
Probably right around. It's either right after the election or coming up shortly before it.
Now try this. Would this be true that one day, the Japanese or other very large investors with the U.S. are going to stop investing, and that should be the trigger, or could be the trigger. Would you think that to be true?
There's no question that if our trading partners don't continue to buy more U.S. debt to recycle our trade deficit, if they don't continue to reinvest that money back into U.S. debt, either stocks or bonds, that will force U.S. interest rates to go higher.
I mean, it's like when the finance company looks at your credit history and says, no, sorry.
Exactly.
You know, for the first
time.
You
end up having to go to a loan shark.
Yeah.
And the consequence of that is, of course, disruptive on your life. When the United States begins to have to pay a real rate of interest to borrow all the money that we need to borrow to roll over our debt, then we'll see the day of reckoning. You know, it's interesting, Art. Right before the September 11th events of 2001, there was a warning published in all of the Russian newspapers by a Dr. Tatyana Koryaga, who was a member of the macroeconomic research group of the Russian Ministry of Economic Development.
What was her specific warning?
She warned that the United States was going to come under a series of terrorist attacks that would collapse the financial system here. And she described the effects as similar to a nuclear bomb being detonated in the financial markets.
Well, we all know what kind of economic bomb 9/11 was, and I think we, just in recent days, have probably seen reverberations of that with what has just occurred in Spain. What am I trying to say? I guess it's in front of us, huh?
Well, I think that's unfortunately the case. And the shock effects of...
What, we've been down several hundred points since Spain?
Well, surely, but, you know, we're... The market itself is already looking pretty heavy.
Yes, but could the market, Benjamin... Take another 9/11 or worse.
Probably not.
You know, you're not the only one saying that. There's a lot of people saying that. That if there was something of that magnitude again, we did go into a gigantic tailspin because of it. And they're still out there, and obviously they're still active. And so
Sure. One
more big hit, and that could be it. There are a number of things, I guess, then, that could bring about this crashing end. Appropriate term, crashing end, or the beginning of the end, right?
I wouldn't say it's going to be the end, but the collapse of the U.S. stock market is definitely in our future. You know, it's a house of cards. You cannot build an empire on credit. It requires true wealth and true savings. And you know, one of the paradoxes of this period of economic prosperity with its so-called productivity miracles is that there's no savings anymore. If America is so wealthy, and if we're now so productive, as the spin masters on Wall Street would tell us, why are there no savings?
We've never been good savers, have we? Americans,
how can
really...
a nation be wealthy and productive and unable to save? We are a nation of credit card junkies.
I know.
I'm sure there's an upper class that's wealthy. They're a small percent of the population. The average American family has virtually no savings.
That's true.
And what's up with that?
Well, what's up with the fact that, as far as I know, even through the best of times, we've never been savers. We just, there's something about Americans that, you know, culturally, I guess, we're not savers.
Well, the United States saved, on average, 8% of its national income 30 years ago.
No, I'm talking
about...
gone. I'm not talking about 30 years ago. I'm talking about today.
Well, and the reason...
And for maybe the last 20 years or more.
And the reason for that, Art, is that people began to use debt to try to replace the lost incomes that were occurring to maintain their living standards.
Yes.
And we became a nation of people who were comfortable mortgaging our future. And we have mortgaged it to levels undreamed of. But the day of paying the piper is indeed coming for America.
Well, you know that old question about, ask yourself, are you better off than you were 4 years ago?
Right.
Nobody really out there right now is urging that question be publicly asked.
No, they're not.
All right, when we come back, we're going to the phones. And we're going to see what people think about all this. You're a complex individual, to be sure, Benjamin. Stay right there. Very complex. on the one hand, he really knows his way around the economy, ours and the international economy, and has a pretty firm grasp on everything. On the other, he speaks to God, and God speaks back to Benjamin. When we come back, we're going to go to the phones and see what you think about all of this. In the dark, in the night, this is Coast to Coast AM, and I'm Art Bell.
Tidal waves, volcanoes, with Art Bell. Call the Wildcard Line at area code 775-727-1295. The first time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5. And dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
Well, we have a real enigma on our hands here with Benjamin Baruch. Very, very interesting individual. He obviously knows what he's talking about in the financial world. There's no question about that. He actually sounds just like my broker when he gets going, up to a certain point anyway. And then on the other hand, we have the Benjamin Baruch who talks to God. And God talks back to Benjamin about things from the stock market to the end of America, certainly as we know it, as he has seen it. In a moment, we're going to go to the phones, and this could be very interesting indeed. All right, well, this is going to be interesting. AZSR22 from Tucson, Arizona, that must be gibberish, huh? Says, this would be humorous if he didn't believe this stuff so much. And that's what's scary about him and all religious fanatics like him. The Bible is just a book of tales of history from the writer's view, and we all know that history is in the eye of the holder. So, you know, probably going to be some of that. You know, you obviously completely believe everything you've told us tonight, right?
Absolutely.
There's not even a scintilla of doubt in your mind that it was God who spoke to you and gave that information to you and gave, well, all of the information in whatever way it came to you. Okay, let's see. First time caller line, you're on the air with Benjamin Baruch. Hello?
Hello?
Yes, sir, you're on the air.
Is that me? Yes. Well, why did God pick you?
Well, I can only guess the answer to that question, and I would offer that he chooses the foolish things to confound the wise.
Oh, how obscure. And furthermore, then, why aren't you the richest man in the world?
Well, you know, in the book of Amos, God picked a migrant farm worker.
No, but his questions, Benjamin, to be fair, is, if you've got a direct line to God and a line on the market and what it's going to do, then you should be real rich.
Well, I'm not going to comment on my financial income or my net worth, but...
But you're okay.
I'm not worried about what's coming, that's for sure.
Well, that somewhat escapes the question in that Bill Gates apparently doesn't have a line directly to God, but he's done quite well.
Yeah, he has, caller. Let's try this again. Would you say you are fairly well-to-do as a result of your activities? I mean, you know, we're asking, were you successful?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, I would be considered a successful
Okay,
person.
Good enough. Yeah, that's a good answer. Wildcard Line, you're on the air with Benjamin Brook. Hello.
Hi, pleasure. I wanted to start off, I watched our favorite movie the other day, Frequency, and it made me think of a quote.
My favorite movie is Contact. Frequency is down a little bit, but right up there.
Okay.
Right up in the top
10. Okay. Well, it's probably not my number one favorite, but I just love it. And I just came across the Bridge of San Luis Rey, and the last line is, there is a land of the living and a land of the dead, and the bridge, dropped the page, and the bridge I know by heart is love, and, hold on, sorry about this.
What are you essentially, put that down for a minute. What are you trying to tell us?
Okay, well, what I'm trying to say is that that I'm very concerned when, I mean, how much money do people need, for starters? Also, when I hear people say things like...
Is that your question, how much money do people need?
Well, no, it's slightly more involved, but not much longer, because I don't want to, take over the whole thing.
No, just give us your question.
Okay, in terms of the monetary, Japan has been holding up the U.S. dollar by buying U.S. dollars when everybody else has been buying euros. It's not going to last. What's going to happen with the trade deficit that has no hope of turning around, because all of your jobs are being outsourced? It's not going to happen. You won't have a surplus.
The only thing that's going to happen is your money's going to collapse. Ma'am, you're preaching to the man who just preached that a minute ago. The exact same thing. So.
Well, my point is we're spending all of this money on weapons of God knows what, how to destroy so many people. Paul Bremer, we asked, how many Iraqis have been killed? Oh, we don't count them.
All right. Well,
the point is that I'll finish here.
Please.
The most important point is that nobody's talking about 9/11. Nobody's talking about Buzzy Krongard and the put options. And that is, I mean, there are so many facts out there that, I mean, why do we believe this theory? I mean, they were going into Afghanistan in the summertime.
What theory?
I'm sorry?
You said, why do we believe this theory?
This theory that the reason we all charged together in unity to Afghanistan to bomb poor old Afghanistan yet again was to get the evil Osama bin Laden, who's a very close family friend of the Bushes. And
okay, well, all right. Well, that's just a political rant. And I don't know that the Bushes are friends with Osama's at all. So I'm sorry about that. That lady really didn't have a question to ask. She had political speech she wanted to make there, Benjamin.
Apparently.
Yeah. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Benjamin Brook. Hello.
This is Dan.
Yes, hello.
How you doing?
Okay.
Yeah, nice talk to you, Art. You got a great show. Benjamin?
Yes?
Yeah, you talked earlier about, like you said, you were talking to a person and then God took over the conversation you wanted him to, you know? And it's happened to me twice. And it's so neat because it's just like words coming out. I don't know how it happened to you. That's what I wanted to ask. It's like words coming out of your mouth. Your mouth is opening and the words are coming out, but they're not your words. Is that how it came to you? That you're telling the person something?
I wouldn't describe it like that, you know, but clearly it was not from me to tell this group the four judgments were coming and then to grab one of the young men by the shoulder and say, and it's just like your arm. I mean, that wasn't originating in my mind. Moments later, when confronted with this, I didn't even remember saying it, but in fact, I did. So clearly it was being directed by in my opinion, the Spirit of God.
Yeah.
So, you know, perhaps, I think maybe we're describing the same thing, but I'm not certain.
West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Benjamin Baruch. Hello.
Hello, Art?
Yes.
Hi, Tim.
You're going to have to speak up good and loud, hon. You're not too loud, so yell at us.
Okay. Hi, Art and Ben. Ben, I would like to thank you for speaking the truth in love and wisdom. And did I get it right that you said America, you felt, was Babylon of the Jewish?
Yes. America is actually the daughter of Babylon. And if you want to read about its future, read Jeremiah 50 and 51.
Okay, so then when the market, money-wise, falls here, do you perceive how soon it might be that we'd have the one-world government, one-world monetary system, and so on and so forth?
And the concentration camps would just be on the road to all of that, right, Benjamin?
That would be correct. And I would say that the collapse of the United States, which will be the total collapse, will be the finale of World War III. We will see the one-world government rise up out of those ashes almost immediately. The nations of the earth will tremble when they see the great America fall in 1 hour, and they'll quickly turn to any solution that's offered to them.
In 1 hour, you're speaking metaphorically, then?
I'm quoting the Book of Revelations, but the final blow against the United States will be a nuclear strike, and that will take place in under an hour.
Yeah.
The financial collapse will precede that. There'll be a series of crises that will escalate. And you can have me back on your show as those waves roll across our nation. We can sort of do the color commentary, Art. Kind of like a football game.
I'm no John Madden. International Line, you're on the air with Benjamin Baruch.
Yes, hello, good evening.
Hi, where are you?
This is Sally from Vancouver, Canada.
Hey, Sally.
Fun, 1410.
Right.
I have two comments and then a question to Benjamin. The comments, Benjamin's last name, Baruch, is blessed in Hebrew, and modern Babylon is actually Iraq. And my question to Benjamin is, Benjamin, when you pray to Hashem and ask him for answers to your questions, I was interested to know, do you speak out loudly and audibly, or do you sort of speak silently and inwardly to yourself?
Yes, very good question. Thank you.
Thank you for speaking the name of the Lord in Hebrew, or the name that is used in reverence, Hashem. I pray both in my heart and verbally, out loud. Absolutely. And to comment on your Babylon point, ancient Babylon, the geographic city, was located in what is now Iraq. But the prophetic symbol of Mystery Babylon is, in fact, a lineage of superpowers that have dominated the earth from time to time, and the United States is part of the final end-time Mystery Babylon, which is ruling the earth.
It has been said by many that there's really not much in prophecy or any place really in the Bible where the United States even seems to be a factor in anything, to be honest with you.
Yeah, that's part of the consensus view. It's wrong. It's so far wrong that it's laughable. The United States is pictured in many places in the prophetic writings. People just don't like the picture, so they conveniently ignore it.
Huh. First time caller line, you're on the air with Benjamin Baruch. Hello.
Hello. I'm looking at things from my perspective, but if you could make an advisement to somebody, say the average American who's in this situation. We have a small mortgage, not a large one, but all of our retirement is tied up in the market. So if something happens to the market and it takes a dive, there goes all of our savings and everything we have, because basically we don't have much of a savings. Like you said, most Americans don't. We don't. Most of our retirement, our savings, is tied up in this market, which is something that our 401Ks there, and everybody has told us put everything there.
So are you kind of sort of asking for personal advice here? That's fine.
I guess you could say that.
Yeah. Well, all right, then fine. Let's ask. Benjamin, there's her situation. She represents many out there. How do you advise her?
Well, everybody's situation is personal, so there's no blanket answer. But this market, in the opinion of Sir John Templeton, who founded the Templeton Funds, is the most overvalued in history. Warren Buffett recently said he can't find any stocks worth buying.
Yeah, I got all that. You gave us all that earlier.
So, you know, that being the case, I would suggest that you move to a more defensive position, and you should allocate some of your money in your 401k to more conservative fund options, either short-term bonds, perhaps some precious metal mining, gold stocks would be appropriate. I would not have 100% of my retirement funds allocated to equities at this time. I think that would be a serious mistake.
Would you say just get out of it?
Well, again, it depends on your exact facts, and without looking at the details of your family's income and net savings and your financial position, I can't make a blanket statement that would be relevant, but
that's fair.
I would err on the side of conservatism.
Benjamin, for people in her general financial condition, which is a lot of people, you know, with 401ks maybe, and not a heck of a lot more toward retirement, with what you know.
Well, I would say the answer is yes, get out.
Okay.
And here's the reason why. After we've had a 20-year bull market, and there's been three of them in the last 100 years, the next 10 years have produced negative real returns. So here you are today. The market has recovered substantially from the lows of a year ago, but the prospects going forward are for very mediocre single-digit returns, and that's the bullish case. So you're taking tremendous risk of the bear market resuming, and in my opinion, the bear's not done, and we're going to create new lows before it's over. And for assuming that risk, all you're getting is an expected single-digit return. It's just not a prudent risk and return trade that I would make today. Mm-hmm. I would sell the majority of my equities. Now, there's always exceptions. I like the energy stocks. I like the gold stocks. But I would not be 100% allocated to stocks.
Yeah, let us for a second talk about gold. I'm very interested in that. Maybe you can explain it to me.
Sure.
In hard times, or when the market does badly, gold does well, traditionally.
Yes.
But gold, for some reason, has, though it hovers right at about the $400 mark and has taken a few upward spikes, it doesn't seem to be rising in alarm as you would expect it to if the market really were in the sort of condition that you are describing.
Well, I think that my viewpoint is the minority. The majority of the professionals that are invested in the market and the Wall Street people that are speaking on the bubble vision that everybody watches are very bullish. The minority opinion is that the bear market's for real and it's not over. Gold is a store of value. People flock to gold in times of uncertainty, and gold, of course, is the ultimate hedge against the debasement of a currency.
Well, why have they not yet flocked?
Well, I think they have, in a sense. Gold's up 30-40% from its lows. The movement in gold, though, has been primarily in U.S. dollars. If you look at gold priced in euros, gold has been pretty well flat.
So should we use gold as the indicator? When it begins to really spike hard, then the end economic game is almost at hand.
I think, look, that's a definite good point. If gold begins to break out of this trading range and start moving up aggressively, that would indicate that something's afoot in the financial market.
Uh-huh. Okay. Wild card line, you're on the air with Benjamin Baruch.
Good morning, Art and Mr. Baruch. This is David calling from, I'm listening to the show on Streamlink.
Okay.
Calling from Illinois. Very impressed with his knowledge, his intelligence, and
yes.
Been looking at some of the things on his website that's back up. One quick question. You do believe then that the U.S. is mentioned in the Bible and prophecy, and as I do, and you also, do you believe that the saving name, Yahshua the Messiah, and Yahweh, that that's the name that we need to call on for salvation in these end times?
Well, Yeshua, which is the name salvation in Hebrew, the name of Jesus, being the Hebrew name, definitely I believe that Yeshua or Jesus Christ is the Messiah of Israel and the King of the universe. And he alone is the name whereby we may be saved. And I do want to make one comment about the website. Apparently, the website, the Day of the Lord is at hand.com, is not up. What's up is a mirrored site that people can get to by connecting or clicking on the link on the Coast to Coast AM.
Well, I told you, Benjamin, we killed it.
You were right, Art.
Yeah, we killed it.
Yeah, we've got a mirror site up.
Uh-huh. Well, at least you've got something up there that people can get to. That's good.
Yeah.
Well, let's see if we can fit one more in here, and I think we can. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Benjamin Burke. Hello.
Hello, Mr. Bell.
Hi.
An honor to speak with you, sir.
And you.
I had a couple of questions for your guest, and maybe you can answer the first one also. Why does it seem like everyone who has these visions or notes from God say that the U.S. is the first country, the first area that's going to be destroyed?
You're making it awful easy on him, the caller. He's going to say, well, if all of us who say we're talking to God are saying that, then maybe you ought to be listening.
Oh, I don't doubt that some people may.
In other words, a common message must have some meaning.
Well, it just seems like everybody says.
I don't mean to answer for you, Benjamin.
That we're the one that the U.S. is being targeted.
Yeah, I've
got
you.
I'm curious as to why.
Yeah, no, I've got you.
You know, that's an interesting.
Yeah, it certainly is. Both of you, hold on through the break, and we'll come right back to it. Yes, as Las Vegas, Nevada, for example, is frequently destroyed in movies about nuclear war and that sort of thing. The United States in general, I guess, because we're the top dog, right? In more ways than one, economically and politically and socially and standard of living wise, we're number one.
Call the Wildcard Line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from East of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From West of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5. And dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
Tis. Good morning, everybody. Benjamin Baruch is here. He talks to God. God talks back to him. He has seen our future as in America's future. And he's a very complex individual, to be sure. I wonder what the consequences of doing what he has done have been. Maybe we'll ask him that. I mean, he's very, very, very outspoken, obviously. And there really are a lot of people who just hate messengers. Okay, remember, we're all adults here, and we are listening to one man and his opinion. And a lot of people don't like messengers. And just a quick side note, I got this from last week. Dear Art, you were speaking to a woman caller last week with respect to the movie The Passion. You asked her what she thought would happen if Jesus, the Master, so to speak, came again. She was so sure it would all be great because, as she said, we're a Christian nation now or something like that. Your reply was that you disagreed and that you think the same kind of thing would happen that it did back then. I was chilled by that. So few understand that perspective. Do we not know that the very people waiting for him slash her and expecting the Master then are the ones who rejected him? The very people waiting here now will reject him again. That's very interesting stuff. Benjamin, welcome back. And the caller, would you please continue, caller?
Yes, sir. Well, my first question was, why are we the one? Why is the U.S. the area that gets destroyed first?
Yes, yes.
Well, there's several reasons. First and foremost, judgment begins in the house of God, and the United States is one of two nations that were divinely created. Every other empire that rose on this planet was the mission of a man who would be king or ruler. But in the case of the United States, it was a movement by God. This country was based on the Bible. We are a Christian nation, or at least we were at one time. And the other nation, of course, that God created was Israel. And the judgment of God upon the earth begins first with his two unique nations that he created for divine purposes. And ironically, the fact that we will be judged first is actually an act of mercy by God. These judgments are designed to turn us back to God, that we would avoid the ultimate destruction that will face the nations that follow the Antichrist. So,
well,
it's a little harsh, but it's...
In other words, said another way, better to be dead.
Well, not everybody's going to die, Art.
Why? But I mean, loosely translated, that's what you just said, though.
No.
Ending.
That's not really what I meant.
Well,
anyway.
Okay, but isn't that the way? That's the way it came out, though. I mean, America will be dealt with first, and it will actually be a merciful thing. That's what you said, I thought.
Yes, but I didn't mean to imply that everybody would be dead.
Well, is it okay to interpret that as being that he gets us and Israel first because we're kind of the favored sons, or?
I would say we're the two nations that were created.
Okay.
For divine purpose, Israel brought the Messiah into the world. The United States brought the gospel of the Messiah to the world.
A divine purpose of destruction?
No, a divine purpose to bring life to humanity. And now, having turned into a harlot and an apostate, we will be cleansed, if you will, by fire.
Okay, I'll ask my other two questions real quickly so to save time. The first one is, if we're the Babylon of the apocalypse in the Bible, it was my interpretation, and I'm not a biblical scholar in any sense of the imagination, I thought the one world government started prior to the destruction of the new Babylon. And secondly...
Well, that's a big one. You better stop there for a second. What about that timeline-wise?
Well, that's a good comment. Let me reiterate, the United States is a part of the final mystery kingdom of Babylon.
The beginning of it, right?
We are the beginning of it. We are specifically the daughter of the final king of Babylon. We are not the end-time superpower that will rule the earth. We're just the reigning superpower at the moment.
So we're part of the catalyst to create that.
Well, let's just say the whole one-world government is sort of modeled after the United States.
Okay.
The United States of the world, if you will, under the UN, which coincidentally was born in New York.
Not San Francisco, but...
Well, that's right. Yeah.
But my final question is if... And it was also... Again, it's just my interpretation, but it wasn't long after the destruction of the New Babylon that pretty much... Everything comes to an end in Revelation. Why were you earlier saying that people should go to Europe? Because it doesn't seem like that would give them all that much more time.
Well, that was Art's comment.
Well, it was my comment, but you kind of agreed with it. I mean, you said that could be one way to...
It's
certainly on the list of things to consider. I mean, if we're going to have an all-out war here, you might want to get out of the line of fire a little bit.
Or, you know, as the old saying goes, if the hydrogen bombs are going to fall, then better to go out there and face up to them and say, hi, baby, I'm ready, and just go out with a flash.
Well, as the saying goes, is it's actually quite ignorant. 80% of the fatalities are the consequence of severe burns and dehydration, and it takes up to 2 weeks to die. So
yeah,
unless you're at ground zero, you're not going to like it.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Benjamin Baruch.
Hi. My name is Jeremy. I am in Colorado. Thanks for taking my call.
You bet.
And I have a few things. Okay, number one, now the, excuse me, I apologize, a little bit nervous, but did Christ not say that a house divided against itself could not stand? And I'm putting that in reference to him healing, because that's basically what his reply to, was to the Jews when they said, excuse me, when they said that, you know, he was healing people by demons. So therefore, wouldn't it be that if one was healed by Judaism mentally, spiritually, physically, or one was healed by Muslim or any of these, that that would actually be part of him? And
okay, that's one. Benjamin?
Okay, and the other one is, he also said...
Well, no, I wanted Benjamin to comment on number one.
I'm not sure what your question
was. Well, that all of them are God, the same.
I don't think you can create that doctrinal statement out of those words by Jesus.
Well...
You know, because Jesus went further to say, many would come in my name and deceive many. Now, they're coming in the name of Jesus, but they are in fact deceiving many, and they are not of God, so... I don't think you can conclude that because some miracle or some sign and wonder occurs that therefore it must be God. As a matter of fact, the scripture tells us at the time of the end, the Antichrist will come with lying signs and wonder to deceive the whole earth. So if we're looking at signs and wonders for authentication of spiritual truth, we're looking in the wrong place. We need to go back and search the scriptures for what is true.
Okay. On the international line, you're on the air with Benjamin Baruch. Hello.
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 Art, I was wondering, I wanted to ask Benjamin, how does he know that God is speaking to him? Does he hear it, or does he...
You mean aloud. The answer was he hears it aloud. Correct,
he
Benjamin?
Hears it aloud.
That's correct, yes.
It's not his own conscience?
Right.
I'm sorry, what was the question?
It's not your own conscience.
No, I hear a voice behind me. I'm turning around to see who's standing there.
Yeah. So this is clearly, you know, it's so hard, Benjamin. You have to understand.
I do understand, Art. I mean, there are examples of people that have heard from God on this level.
Yes.
But they're very rare. I didn't know that until I began to try to tell people about this message, And I learned the vast majority of people who claim to believe in God have never heard from him.
Mm-hmm.
I was actually kind of surprised because it was sort of normal for me.
Okay, you wrote a book called The Day of the Lord is at Hand.
That's right.
Is this book in the mainstream, I don't know, usual places?
No.
So yes, this is a self-published deal.
Actually, it was published by a very wealthy businessman. I wrote it as a manuscript thinking I would merely give it to my friends and family. A very wealthy friend took the manuscript on vacation to Hawaii. His wife began reading it at 9 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
They stayed up all night and finished it at 8 in the morning, and they're in their 60s. And if you can imagine a book that would keep a 60-year-old couple up pulling an all-nighter, that's this book.
Well, that's pretty unusual, all right. And I assume that it's available then through your website, right?
Well, it is carried by, or was carried, I should say, by a number of bookstores around the country. It's being republished. It may be on Amazon. At the moment, it's not. But it will be available through the website, and it's available both in an electronic form as well as
Okay.
A hard copy.
All right. Excellent. First time caller line, you're on the air with Benjamin Baruch.
Hello?
Hi.
Hi. This is Gwen. I'm calling from South Carolina.
Hello, Gwen.
Hi there. I want to say Baruch Abba Hashem Adonai Eloheinu.
Hello, Gwen.
Hi there. I want the audience to know that Benjamin has the voice of a prophet. He will not call himself a prophet, because a true prophet will not acknowledge that he's a prophet, because then he's elevated himself. He is actually hearing from Yahweh. Yahweh is the sacred name who the Gentiles call God, okay? And the reason America is going to be the first one is because America has bowed her knees at Balaam, okay? Because she, back in the 60s, when they took the Bible and prayer out of school, that's when God took his hands, Yahweh, mm-hmm. took his hands off this country and let us have what the people in this nation wanted.
Benjamin, hold it. Ma'am, this is an incredibly common view now.
It's the truth, sir.
Uh-huh.
I
understand.
It's the truth.
No, there are many in America who feel that when God was taken from the schools and when we began to, draw this line.
Right, that's when abortion went up. That's when a drug, there was a group of people that are not believers that did a survey and found out that teen pregnancy went up about 800%. Mm-hmm. It began when all that happened.
So that was the turning point.
Right, that's correct. And this nation was based on the Holy Scriptures. It was based on the Tanakh and the Brit Hadashah. But we have strayed from that. And if this nation would truly repent, according to 2 Chronicles, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face.
All right.
This country has never done it.
All
so
right.
Judgment is coming.
All right, gotcha. All right, thank you. Benjamin...
Well, Art, I just want to make one comment. I'm a very successful businessman. I've got a very successful career. I make a lot of money for what I do. I make more money in a month than most people make in a year. I didn't need to write some wacky book and bring some crazy message. I'm one of the people winning this game. And I laughingly tell my friends, I know why there's no jobs in America. It's because I'm hogging all of them.
Mm-hmm.
I've got all the jobs, Art.
Mm.
4 or 5 of them every day. But no, in all seriousness, I didn't bring this book forward. It came out pretty much with its own head of steam. I'm not some guy who's got nothing better to do. I wrote this manuscript, which was ultimately published by somebody else after they read it, really to try to reach my friends and family. I never dreamt it would be published. It got published. It ended up ending in the hands of a TV network back east. I ended up on national television, on international radio, and I'm here tonight on your fine show. My purpose is not to divide, not to bring an argument, but to basically tell everybody the warning is here. God has told us what he's going to do. The good news is, his intentions with each of us are actually very kind and loving. He just has had enough of murder. He's had enough of the horror of sin. And he is bringing this to conclusion. And it's a good thing, because if this went on indefinitely, I don't think any of us could stand what would be happening.
There are so many of us, Benjamin, so many of us that have such a terrible struggle with the mental concept of a God that would have knowledge of what the creatures that he created would do and let it all unfold like some cruel orchestrated joke.
Well, it's not a joke. It wasn't meant to be cruel and orchestrated as a joke.
I'm using those as dramatic terms here.
Art... I can't stand in judgment of the Supreme Being. I can only understand what he allows me to comprehend about himself, his character, his purposes.
Will you do me a personal favor?
Sure.
Next time you get a chance to talk with him,
mm-hmm.
ask him what's up with that.
And if he gives me an answer, I'll forward it.
Well, yeah, exactly. In fact, if he gives you an answer to that one, I'll bring you back.
Okay.
He wants some enticement. Because that's what so many people want to know. I mean, it seems such a macabre dance with the end known and the puppet strings being pulled on all of us down here. That's just such a tough concept.
It is. I empathize with you completely. But we are still left with the dilemma of reality.
Mm-hmm. Is there a way to ask this? How frequently do you have an opportunity to converse with God?
I have been able to hear from him on some occasions, on a daily basis, and at other times really? I've spent years without hearing a word. So it kind of comes and goes.
How do you, and how do you interpret those long absences without word? Do you begin to doubt? Do you begin to question ever your own sanity?
Well, no. I don't question my sanity, and I don't doubt God or his word, but I do feel a whole lot better when he's talking to me than when it's all quiet for years at a time.
Yeah. There are a lot of us who would like that to happen. God has never had one word with me. Not one word. And so I've got a feeling that I'm probably in pretty good company. In other words, you're pretty rare. Not entirely rare. I mean, I'm seeing computer messages. God talks to me, too. So I guess a lot of people believe that, Benjamin.
Yeah, there's a large group of people that believe they hear from God. I have spoken to a number of them, and in this hour, I'm skeptical of a lot of what is quoted as from God is, in fact, real. We were warned in the Bible that in the last days many false prophets would come. And the caller beforehand basically said someone who claims to be quoting God is
a prophet,
is operating as in the office of a prophet.
Well, hey.
This is an hour when there will be many misquotes and many false prophets.
But look, from the listener's point of view, you do come across clearly as a prophet, a man who has received a message that he's supposed to take forth. And
I can quote God. When God showed me the judgment that will come on the United States, I fell down on my face in my living room weeping and screaming. And I cried out, Lord, what must we do to be saved? And I heard him audibly, Art, and he said, I will protect that which is mine, and everything else will be destroyed. And then I asked him, I need to know what to do, and I can't hear from some man in this hour. I must hear from you. And then he answered, and he said, search the scriptures for the detailed instructions.
All right, listen.
This hour are in the Word of God.
Yeah, this hour is over, actually. So, Benjamin, thank you for, you're a very unusual guest, and I thank you for being here.
Well, thank you, Art. It was a pleasure.
Yeah, good. Oh, one last question, Benjamin. Still there?
Yep.
When you do die, that thing about going to the light, you think that's true?
Well, it sure seems like it would be.
All right, thanks.